I am Assemblyman Steve McLaughlin, and want to welcome you to this forum. It is obviously a vital topic, a frightening topic, and quite frankly, some of us are still learning as we go here. And forums like this help us as legislators as we go back into session in just a few months from now in January. These are the type of things that are helpful to us, and we hope very helpful to you as well. They're very helpful to us as we craft legislation or advocate for existing legislation that has not yet been passed. And for those of us here on the panel that have spent time in Albany, it takes time sometimes to build up the momentum to get things passed. And certainly my colleagues in the legislature can attest to that, that sometimes it takes four or five sessions or sometimes longer to get a bill passed. But I think the other thing that I've learned in my time in Albany is Albany is really a noise meter, and it responds to noise. So when the public is making noise, legislators and the governor pay attention. So this is the noise we need to create to bring awareness to this issue. So just want to thank everybody for being here. We're going to try to keep this moving along tonight and get everybody out of here on time or pretty close to on time. So I just want to take a moment. I'm going to run down right down the list and introduce my colleagues that have joined me, in some cases close. Jim Todisco is close over in Schenectady County, but some have traveled as far away as Suffolk County. And Joe, where's Joe? Out in the middle of the state somewhere, about 4 or 5 hours away. So with no further ado, you all probably know Assemblyman Jim Todisco. He's been in office for quite some time, and Jim and I work together on a lot of issues. Jim is over in the Schenectady area and some of the Saratoga area as well. So Jim joins us. We appreciate that. Assemblyman Al Graff, one of our task force members. Al is up from Suffolk County. Assemblyman Joe Giglio is the chairman of this task force. And Al and Joe will be traveling throughout the state, much as we did on Common Core last year. Al and Joe have taken it upon themselves to host these task forces and to sponsor these events as we raise awareness, not only here, but in every reach of New York State, because this is an issue that faces every single corner of this state. We're joined by our friend Tony Jordan, who was a colleague of ours in the Assembly, but is now the DA of Washington County, so we appreciate Tony being here. Pat Russo, a 28-year veteran of the Troy Police Force, and he has been the undersheriff of Rensselaer County for 12 years, and then in November he will be the sheriff, and I can say that with authority because he has no opponent. So that one's that's pretty easy, and that's music to everyone up here's ears that's in elective office to have no opponent. But Pat will be taking the reins as sheriff in January. Bill DeJoy joins us. Bill's a clinical director who's worked with adolescents and their families for 15 years as a clinical social worker, a private practitioner, and administrator in outpatient, inpatient, psychiatric, and inpatient substance abuse treatment. He's currently the clinical director at Conifer Park. So, Bill, we thank you for joining us. Brian Farr is with us. Brian is the chair of recovery advocacy in Saratoga. He's credentialed alcoholism and substance abuse counselor at St. Peter's Hospital. He's coordinator of addiction studies at Hudson Valley Community College, where he's a board member on the prevention council and a person in long-term recovery. Sandra here. We're waiting on Sandra McCarthy. Hopefully Sandra will be able to join us. She is a Rensselaer County conflict defender. Brian Prinz down at the end. Brian is a member of Young People in Recovery in the Albany chapter, and he's in the HVCC Chemical Dependency Program and a person in long-term recovery who is a student here at Hudson Valley as well. So Brian, thank you for joining us. And I see a few folks in the audience. We have a city council member from Troy. Jim Gordon is here. Tom Casey, retired fire captain. Father Peter Young. Patty Farrell will be speaking as well. So a number of folks here. And we want to hear from you first and foremost. And lastly, but certainly not least, a friend of mine and our moderator, Stephanie Campbell. Stand up, Steph. Can they see you back there? Steph is Stephanie. She's a dynamo. She has extensive experience in education, policy, and journalism, She holds an MA from Columbia University and an MS in Adolescent Education from SUNY Albany. She worked in the State Assembly before I got there. I didn't cause her to leave, but she left before I got there. But she was in the State Assembly and the State Senate, and she's done legislative advocacy at both the state and federal level. Steph is going to be our moderator tonight, and she'll kind of fill you in on what she's going to do when she speaks. But I just want to take a moment and let the panel just say hello for a second, and then we'll get this underway, and we'll hear from all of you. Thank you so much for being here.
Go ahead, Joe. Okay. Well, first of all, let me thank all of you for coming out to enlighten us and to help us hear others enlighten us about this serious and sensitive issue. And thank you to Steve for hosting the forum, and my colleagues, Assemblyman Giglio and Assemblyman Graff. You know, I've been a public servant for quite a long time, and I've come to understand that the most important part about being a public servant and a representative is to be able to communicate. But communication is a two-way street. And what I found out is it's most important to be a good listener rather than a good speaker. So I'm not going to talk too much. We have some professionals here, some people who have been involved in this issue. I know some people who want to speak out. I want to listen tonight and learn tonight, and hopefully with my colleagues bring back some information that will help enlighten our other colleagues and our legislative bodies so we can do something about this dangerous and dastardly situation of not only heroin but the drugs that are in our streets. And I'm interested in three areas and hearing about three areas. How can we get this drug and others off our streets and available to the people, our kids and our families? How can we educate them to the extent that they understand the dangers of involving themselves with a dastardly drug like heroin and the addiction it provides and the monkey it puts on their back? And thirdly, what can we do when they are involved and addicted to not only protect them, change them, but protect the innocent, honest, and law-abiding citizens who are impacted by the fact that they have gotten themselves involved with this serious situation. I know we have programs already, but there might be a better and more significant way to deal with those people who have this type of addiction. I appreciate the fact that our law enforcement bodies now in areas across the state are bringing an antidote to individuals who are overdosing. But that's after the fact. I'd rather not have them overdose because they're not involved with this type of drug. And that should be our goal, not to have them utilizing this drug so we don't have to save their lives when they're in a situation where their very lives are at stake. So I thank you for being here. Thanks, Steve, and hopefully I'll be able to listen and learn. Thank you so much.
Again, I'd like to echo Assemblyman Todisco's remarks of thanking you all for being here and welcoming us. You know, one of the things that I value, I'm the district attorney for Washington County, the county just to the north of Rensselaer on the Vermont border, and we are always trying to find better and more effective ways to help people who run afoul of law enforcement as a result of their addiction. One of the questions, though, you know, Jim raised it, but I'm often asked, what can we do, meaning people in the community? Saturday, we had a drug take-back initiative with great fanfare. What's disappointing about that to me is a year ago, the federal government, with little fanfare, came out and said there will be new initiatives and regulations requiring pharmacies to take back Percocet, Oxycontin, Oxycodone, and the opioid drugs that have led to and contributed significantly to the current problem. That has never occurred. And so what can you all do is reach out to primarily your federal legislators, but also, you know, these folks up here, support them and ask them to push that through. As a quick aside, my wife had hip surgery. She received 80 Percocets, used 11. That meant 69 were in the house. Now, I'm lucky because I work next door to the sheriff, but most people do not. And it is those pills that are causing the current problem. So again, I'm thrilled to be here. Anything I can do to help, I look forward to hearing from you folks. And again, thank you all for putting this together.
I'd like to thank you also for inviting me tonight and for your attendance, and to see if we can come up with some solutions for this problem. I've been a cop for 40 years. Eight of those I supervised a narcotic unit there was primarily when crack cocaine was an epidemic, and this is the worst drug that I've seen come down the pike. We need a full court press by law enforcement, by our treatment centers, and by our education and prevention to attack this problem. And people are dying every day from overdoses. We have Narcan in our sheriff's office. We've saved some lives by Narcan. Unfortunately, that doesn't correct the problem with the addict, and we've had situations where the person will go out a month later and nobody's around and they'll overdose, and we weren't there to save them. So we need a full court press by law enforcement, by our elected officials, and we have to get some good, solid programs in place to attack this problem.
Good evening. My name is Bill DeJoy. I'm the clinical director at Conifer Park. I work at primarily the inpatient site in Glenville. And every day we're seeing new and newer people who are addicted to heroin and other opiates. It's something that when I first started at Conifer 10 years ago, our detox unit maybe had a smattering, maybe five, six people who were actively using heroin. This morning we had 32 patients on our detox unit, and 27 of them were primary opiate dependency. It's something that has just blown up and gotten so out of whack and out of proportion to everything else in society. And I think one of the things that we're seeing is that the people who are addicted to opiates and the opiates themselves are requiring that we put on a different headset for treatment. We can't just take treatment for an alcoholic or someone who uses cannabis and decide to just switch it up and say, great, let's just call it opiates. It's not the same beast at all. So we really need to get thinking and get working on that end of treatment and really working together. It's great that we have this panel. It's great that we have everyone here. This is a drop in the water of the ocean for what we need to do. It's a huge uphill battle, but it's worth fighting. So thank you very much for being here.
Yes, I'm Brian Farr. Is this on? Oh, yeah. I'm Brian Farr, and as was mentioned, I run the chemical dependency program down here at Hudson Valley. I also am the chairperson for RAISE, which is Recovery Advocacy in Saratoga. I'm just curious, how many of you have seen the movie The Anonymous People, with a show of hands? Okay, if you have not seen that movie yet, I really highly recommend it. Something you can do. It's on Netflix. You can get it from the public library. I was with Janine Stuchin earlier today, and we taught a class at Empire State College to mature students, and we showed snippets of that film. The times are changing in terms of how we deal with treatment, how we deal with recovery. To even be able to come out here and have this discussion and have politicians and lawmakers and treatment people in the same room, I think, is a huge step forward. As was also mentioned, I wear a lot of different hats. My real passion is trying to help with the use, abuse, and dependence on substances. I would not be here if I was not a person in long-term recovery myself. So tonight we're here to talk about opiates and opioids and heroin. The bigger message that I have seen, not just in my own personal life, but in doing this business, is that sobriety and a life in sobriety is extremely rewarding. And that when we talk about opiates or opioids or heroin, to me I see the out of control use of painkillers. We are in pain. We are a society that is in emotional and physical pain. How we start to turn that around, how we start to deal with family members who have lost people, how we effectively use medications to taper off this powerful drug are all challenges, but I certainly think the minds up here, I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience, I think we're up to that challenge, and I just really want to thank you for having me up here tonight. I'm honored, and thank you folks for coming out tonight as well.
Hello, everybody. My name is Brian Prince. I'm a person in recovery. I just want to thank you all for coming out here tonight, and thank you for asking me to come here and represent being a person in recovery. I am in recovery from heroin addiction, so I know what that beast is like. I went through it. I've been to jail. I've been to institutions, and now I'm in recovery, and I've had maintained in recovery, and now I've gotten to a point in my life where I'm starting to go back. I'm back in school now, like was mentioned. I'm actually in the CASAC program here, and I've rebuilt all the relationships I broke in my life with my family members, you know. And, it's a struggle. You know, it's really bad right now. I know I've met a lot of people over the years, you know, in programs that struggled with heroin. And I've lost close friends of mine to this addiction. And I've been there. You know, I'm not too far removed from it at all. And it is really as bad as people are saying it is. And, you know, I recently just became Narcan certified. I carry it around in my car, and you know, because I want to be there to help someone like me. You know, they just need help. And so, really, I'm an open book. If you guys have any questions specifically for someone who's in recovery, I can answer it. I'll try my best. You know, I'm just really glad to be here. You know, that's really all I got.
Okay, thank you. My name is Joseph Giglio. I do come from the far west. After me is Ohio or Pennsylvania. Most people think I represent there, including Mr. Tedisco. But the fact of the matter is it's Brian Kolb, the minority leader, put this conference, had us put this together for our conference, and we will be circling the state to find out what's going on in the state. Now, a year ago, we passed a lot of legislation in the Senate and the Assembly that was meant to help. We think it helped, but we don't think it helped enough. So that's part of the reason we're out here. We need from you stories and ideas on how to solve the problems, where you see the weaknesses in the system. This has many parts, as you can see from the people that are just sitting up here. There's a lot of moving parts to this, and there's no one easy answer. And we realize that. So what we're doing as a conference is trying to find out and identify what's the best way to move forward. Some of that may be more funding for agencies that already exist. Some of these may be new laws that will help us get people into rehab. Some of this may be things that we haven't done yet that might help us with halfway houses and things of that nature. I mean, God bless you, young man. I'm glad you're here. But there's more of them out there. And we need to help them. We need to bring them in. We need to have the courts have the tools necessary to get people into treatment or into detox and then help them after the Narcan. So we have a lot of things on our plate. We're looking forward to you to talk to us about it. I want you to think of this as just across your kitchen table. Just because we're sitting up here on a stage is really meaningless. We're here as if we're in your kitchen or my kitchen to talk about what your problems are, where you think we can help, where you think the biggest gap is in services, how we can get to preventive parts of this. I mean, we want to start with prevention, but we also want to finish off that when somebody does have a problem, we get them into rehab and get them through rehab and on the road to recovery and to becoming the citizens we all hoped they would be and spare families any more grief and loss, and especially if you lost a child. We want to do as much as we can to prevent that. So thank you very much for coming.
My name is Al Graff, and I'm from Long Island, Suffolk County, and I was a New York City police officer. But today's heroin addicts aren't the same heroin addicts that we had in the 80s. Today, they're your children, they're your nieces, your nephews, your next-door neighbor's kid, and they're even parents. And what we're trying to do is we already held one forum, and there's a lot of reoccurring things that are coming up that we may be able to fix. So some of the problems are that I'll have parents come in to me and they want to get their kid into rehab and their kid's ready to go into rehab. There's no beds. There's a 2 or 3 week waiting period, okay? Everything's focused. We had stories, and this is what we want to get from you. What's the pitfalls? What's the commonality throughout the state? And if you look at it, the other thing that we have is somebody will go to check themselves into rehab, but they're not sure if they have a bed or not. And they're sitting there, and they don't know if they have a bed. And all of a sudden they start itching and everything else, and they go, I'm not going through withdrawal, all right, if I don't know I have a bed. So they go out and shoot up. And then what happens is the rehab won't take the person because they're high, all right? So after the last forum, we've been doing this for 4 months, sitting there brainstorming, looking at different laws. And the last forum was helpful because it made me look at recovery totally different. It was recovery was get the person into rehab, okay? But after the last forum, and I want to hear your pitfalls. I want to hear the problems that you had. I'm looking at recovery as three distinct phases. Phase one's detox. You have to detox the person. You have to wean them off any medication that they're on. And we have to do a medical and psychological profile and do an independent patient care plan. Okay, that's step one. And during that time, they've got to set up the rehab. They've got to set up the insurance and everything else, because that's another problem is insurance doesn't want to pay for this. We've got reports of people that OD'd and they gave them Narcan. They go to the hospital. They released them 2 hours later. Okay. I had a 14-year-old girl from the last one who the parents brought her in there and they told her she was too young to detox. Bring her home and detox her yourself. We want to know what's going out there. There's a lot of different components to this. It's not one silver bullet. We want to give tools to the court. We want to give tools to the parents. For instance, your child is above 16. You can't force your child into rehab. You can't help your loved one. One of the things we're looking at is the Marchman Act. And what the Marchman Act does is if your loved one is addicted to heroin, you can petition the court, okay, to put that person into recovery or into rehab. So there's a lot of things we're looking at. And what we need to do is we need to listen to you. I want to know the pitfalls. I want to know the problems that you're facing, because you're the ones fighting for your loved ones, okay? And you're in the front line. What is it you need from us? What tools do you need from us? There's a lot of working parts to this. I just gave you a little bit of it. What we're trying to do here today is enter into a conversation. We're here to listen to you. We're here to listen to the pitfalls that you've seen. We're here to listen to the problems that you're aware of. We're here to listen to suggestions, okay? We got a lot of that in the last forum. That's what this is about. That's what we're looking to do. I want to thank everybody for coming here today. This is a huge problem throughout the whole state, and I'm going to look forward to having a conversation with you tonight that will push us in a direction. Thank you.
So I want to welcome everyone here. I first of all want to thank you for taking time out of your busy day to come join us and to share with us, you know, your experiences as family members, your experiences as people in the treatment community, and your experiences as folks in recovery. So we're looking at three pieces here. We're looking at prevention, we're looking at treatment, and we're looking at recovery. And I think our panel here is going to listen to your comments, because really this is, as the assembly member said, this is your forum. This is your safe space in which you can tell your stories as members of this community, be you parents, be you family members, loved ones, educators, people in the community. We want to hear from you. So we're going to start off, and just to give you some parameters, I'm going to try not to be too rigid in the three-minute rule, because we do have a number of people here. So if you see me do this, that means I'd like you to wrap it up. So 3 minutes each, if we can. And we're going to start off with our lead speaker, who is Robert J. Lindsay. He is the CEO of Friends of Recovery New York. And he's going to start us off.
I'm using that. All right. Hello there. The Friends of Recovery New York, is this on?
Yeah.
Good deal. Friends of Recovery New York is a statewide organization dedicated to giving a voice to individuals and families in recovery, people struggling with addiction, and to families who have lost someone to addiction. As we've already said, literally everyone is impacted and affected directly and indirectly by alcoholism and addiction. 23 million people in this country over the age of 12 are addicted to alcohol and other drugs. But the good news, and the news that none of us really hear a lot about, is that we also estimate that almost 23 million people are living life today in recovery. So I have spent my entire career in this field, having started as a volunteer when I went to college. But I'm really here today primarily as a family member. I have 11 family members living life in recovery from alcoholism and addiction, ranging anywhere from my cousin down in Florida who's got almost 40 years to my sister-in-law in Boston who's got almost 120 days. For too long, those of us in recovery, families impacted and affected, have been silent. We've really been impacted by this disease in a way that we didn't feel comfortable and confident to be able to come out and speak up and talk about how important this issue is. But now, with your help, and with the help of everybody in this room, we are absolutely changing that entire conversation. And what we want to do is to set priorities that are really based on real life experience rather than just general thoughts and comments on this. So number one for us, silent no more. It's time to speak up and stand up and talk about addiction and recovery. We need to overcome the stigma that literally prevents millions of individuals and families from seeking help. And we need to break down the barriers that are created by stigma and that result in the discrimination. And that discrimination plays out in policy, in terms of access to health care and to services. It plays out in housing, employment, and education. It is true both for the individual and for the family. The reality is that we invest far too little tax dollars in addiction service. We spend literally $4.4 billion on developmental disabilities annually. We spend $4 billion on mental health services annually. We spend $600 million on addiction services. So plain and simple, many of the barriers that we all face trying to get people help is simply a function. We've not invested enough dollars to make services accessible. So that a couple of other thoughts just very quickly. The reality is that I have great admiration and respect for the people that are going to stand up and talk tonight. It is not easy for those that are living with this to stand up and to talk publicly about our life and our experiences. But I really appreciate all that everybody that's going to do. Nobody's voice is more important than your own. So that as we look at this issue, we want to focus on identifying the barriers and recommending solutions. And solutions, from our standpoint, number one, plain and simple, is about dollars and making this a priority in New York State. Number two, access to treatment and to recovery support services. The reality is that all too frequently we're designing treatment for people around what's available as opposed to what they need. We're literally setting them up for failure. And then the third one is we have to expand access and support for family members. Education, information provided in a neutral way, face-to-face with families literally all across New York State. Family members are frequently viewed as an attachment to the person who's seeking help and treatment. They needed to be treated in a very, very different way. So the last comment that I will have for you, many of us in this room are headed to Washington on Sunday for a Unite to Face Addiction recovery rally. If you're not going to Washington, Courtney's in the back, Stephanie's here, I'm here. Talk to any of us. We have a bus leaving in Albany on Sunday morning at 4 a.m. How exciting does that get? All right, so the last comment I'll make is thank you to all the assemblymen for taking the time to be here and for all the other panelists. Really appreciate the chance to be here. Thanks.
Thank you, Bob. We're going to start the evening off with Julianne Brennan.
So just an off note to Assemblyman Graff. My son was one of those ones. He overdosed, and I got to the hospital, and he was there for a couple hours. I'm so grateful that he's here with me today. Please don't get me wrong. I don't mean to talk like I'm ordering out a pizza, but if we don't, then we don't survive. So excuse my trying to be so serious about it. But so I got there, and they thought they were going to have to give him Narcan again. So I sat and watched him, go in and out, watched his breathing, the whole nine. I'm sure all these people will say the same. I see people shaking their heads. And then it was time to go home a few hours later. So we went home, and he was 22 at the time. And so I slept on one couch while my 22-year-old slept on another couch, and I kept watching his chest go up and down. And, I thought to myself, is this even real, but it is real. So first I want to start by thanking all of you folks, Friends of Recovery New York, and everyone who made it possible to have this forum. It is so crucial that we move forward toward recognizing addiction as the epidemic that it is. We must learn more about and improve all aspects of addiction recovery treatment and co-occurring mental illness disorders, and we must recognize that addiction is a family disease. We must move ahead to educate people about all of the components, which are huge, that addiction includes. And as important, we need to let those who are directly affected by someone else's addiction know that there is help and that they are not alone. Addiction is a progressive chronic brain disease. Scientific testing and brain imaging have proven that addiction damages and alters brain areas that are crucial to decision-making, learning, memory, and behavior control, which helps to explain the compulsive behaviors and destructive consequences of addiction. Simply put, with addiction, brain gets hijacked. Evidence-based studies have also shown that therapy, medication when applicable, and support from family members, friends, and community are vital to the recovery process. Let me say that again, the recovery process. While the disease of addiction is incurable, recovery is possible. It's real. But if we don't change the direction that this country is headed toward regarding the road to recovery, people are going to continue to die. Public misunderstanding of addiction is profound. It is not yet recognized for the disease that it is. Like cancer or diabetes, this disease does not discriminate. It knows no bounds, no color, no monetary status, no intelligence level, no religion or geographical location is exempt. The stigma attached to substance abuse is so devastating that unfortunately some people with substance abuse disorders are afraid to get the treatment, and for those who do, the journey can be just as overwhelming and devastating as the disease itself for many reasons. When someone has a life-threatening disease, wouldn't it make sense to give the quickest, most intensive treatment immediately? Then as the patient slowly recovers, their checkups and treatments gradually change in level as they get better. Isn't that what we do? We would think. With addiction, the treatment path is literally backwards. The current concept is to start with the smallest level of treatment for an addicted person, and as the patient fails to recover, they might get lucky and be elevated to the next level of treatment, if their insurance will cover it, and if they're not already dead. This is insane, and it's unacceptable. We wouldn't dream of asking someone with cancer to meet certain criteria for treatment and then kick them out of the hospital if they fail to meet that criteria. Would we treat a cancer patient for 30 days and send them back into the community with no follow-up care and just hope for the best? Why then do we treat the disease of addiction so differently from other diseases that are life-threatening? My 24-year-old son is one of the millions of people in this country with the disease of addiction. Is his life less valuable than another because of that? And why on earth would we want to be part of the problem when we can be part of the solution? Among many things, we need to address the following, and there are a lot, and I just touched the surface, as you folks already all alluded to. The stigma toward addiction, recovery treatment programs, and the improvements that need to be made, treating each patient case as individual, since every case is different, insurance difficulties, duration of recovery treatment, follow-up treatment, treating dual diagnosis, and this is critical, such as bipolar and anxiety and depression while treating the addiction, which my son has dual diagnosis. Information for people on how to navigate this complex treatment system. I'm just going to interrupt my son. When you find out your loved one, I don't care if it's your child, your neighbor, who it is, has the disease of addiction, your brain can't even process it. And then you're supposed to know what to do on top of it. You have to have somebody to go to say, what is my first step? I mean, you can't even reach the door. And that's from personal experience. But how do you know what to do? We also need introduction of treatment programs in jails and prisons that don't already have them, and recovery treatment for families and loved ones of the addict. How can we pretend that we don't know what's happening when overdosing is now the leading cause of accidental death, accounting for more deaths than traffic accidents or gun homicides and suicides? I read that that's the equivalent of a jumbo jet falling out of the sky every day with no survivors. If that ever happened, and it was for another reason, this country would be up in arms. Why is it any different? I'm not a social worker or a scientist or a therapist. I'm just a mom with an addicted son. But I will not be silent and allow this broken system to leave my son behind, or your daughter, or your neighbor, or anyone. And you shouldn't be either. Be an advocate. Stand up, speak up, do whatever you know how to do to make a difference. Changes are happening. I've seen it. The folks here tonight want to make change, but they need our help and our input. We need to be a part of the solution. I dishonor my son if I don't. We dishonor those who are no longer here to stand up to addiction if we don't. And we dishonor every person that is currently living in long-term recovery. I believe in recovery. I've seen it. It's possible. It's real. It's time to do the right thing and make changes. Make no mistake about it. My son's journey to recovery was and is still filled with incredulous challenges. But fighting for treatment to stay alive shouldn't be one of them. Thank you.
Julie? Julie?
Thank you, Julian.
We want to ask you some questions.
So, and if you come up here, please, by all means, sit down, relax, grab the microphone when you talk.
I am going to sit down. Yeah. I have some balance issues because I had a little brain surgery, so I'm going to sit.
Okay, good. Okay. There are, again, when we were talking about reoccurring themes and some of the things you talked about right now, one of the things you mentioned was you probably went in there, it was the first time your son overdosed,
yes,
and you knew, had no clue that he was taking heroin. Most people don't.
I did.
Okay. But there was no guidance. They didn't give you a number to call at the hospital. They didn't give you any information. There wasn't really any training for the medical personnel in order to tell you where you could reach out for help. It was, am I right?
That's exactly correct. And
I think you could take that out.
The
microphone.
Oh. Okay, there we go. Thank you. No, that's exactly correct. And they told him, do you know how lucky you are? And you know, obviously we know how lucky we are. He's still breathing, but he's addicted to heroin. I mean, he didn't even know what his name was. And again, I'm so grateful. I don't mean to say I'm not, but that was what we got. Do you realize how lucky you are? And why don't you wait for a little while longer? Because we may have to Narcan him again. And that was it, literally. Then they came in and looked at him, and they said, okay, you can go.
No follow-up.
And again, I'm grateful, but that's not.
The other thing that we, and I want to see if this is your case too, when you went through the insurance, you know, they say it's 28 days, 30 days, but it really becomes like 10 days, 8 days. And the other problem is if you're looking at rehab, and I just want to see if you're finding this in your area, they'd say in order to go inpatient, no, you have to fail out of outpatient so many times. Three times in order to go into inpatient.
And that's exactly when it first began, I was told all of those things. I was in a position where sometimes, and I always say to my other parents that are in the same position, I was in the right time at the right place a couple of times. A couple of times I wasn't. Sometimes, I don't know, maybe I was so distraught that they felt sorry and you know, maybe moved a few more mountains for me. But no, insurance... After, my son's name is Adam, after Adam overdosed and died and they brought him back, I got a letter from CDPHP that said that they could not cover him for inpatient services because he is not a threat to himself or to others in the community. So I called them and I said, oh, right, because he's not dead. is, but if he was dead, then you wouldn't have to cover him, so you can't have it both ways, you know. So that was huge. I still have that letter. Also, one of the inpatients that my son was in, I had to bring a lot of money because I have a very high deductible, and I had to bring it, and I had to bring cash because in order to get him in, you know, they're like, if it covers, we'll reimburse you, but that's the only way you can get him in. So needless to say, I did it. I did get the money back like 90 days later. But again, not the point. What if I didn't have the money? I mean, through God's grace, I had it. What if I didn't? So while so many things are wonderful about some of these, you know, inpatients and some of these recovery treatment programs, there's so much that is broken and so much that has to be fixed. And really everything that you folks all talked about too. I mean, you know the problems. And we're all going through it. I can see all these, I know.
Okay, thank you. You know, we'll be talking to other people, but you've reaffirmed some of the things that we've heard in other parts too.
Thank you.
Thank you. I also want to introduce one of our panelists, Sandy McCarthy. If you could just say hello and tell us what you're doing.
My name is Sandy McCarthy. I'm sorry I was late. I had my time mixed up. But I'm a public lawyer, so I advocate all the time to try to get people in treatment instead of sending them to prison or to jail. And, you know, I fight that battle every day, you know, with the courts, with the prosecution, at always trying to look for the treatment alternative for someone instead of just throwing away into the incarceration system. I know that the treatment centers, they say there's only one in 30 people, I guess, who completes a 28-day program who will stay clean and sober for a year after discharge. But it's my theory that zero in 30 will stay clean for one day after getting out of jail, right? Every single one, 100%. And they have no idea how to even treat their disease, or as the woman was just saying, they don't even really know what's wrong with them or why they keep ending up in jail all the time. So that's what I do. I advocate to try to, and it's mostly poor people that I deal with because I'm a public lawyer.
Thank you. So just to frame what we're going to do, we're going to try and limit the addressing you folks for 3 minutes. And then at the end, we're going to leave 15 minutes for the panel to then address the community members in terms of what's been said. So that gives, you know, parents and people in recovery and in the treatment world time to speak. But we do thank those who've spoken so far. So the next person is Patty Farrell. Patty?
Good evening. My name is Patty Farrell. I thank you for inviting me tonight. I'm the mother of Larie Farrell Lincoln. She was born on March 21st, 1994, and she passed away from a heroin overdose 5 days before her 19th birthday. She was using for about 4 months. She had come to me, told me she was using. Took her to detox, or took her to the emergency room. They put her in detox. Detox took her. But because she was old enough, she was 18, she checked herself out the next day. Kept saying she could do it herself, she could do it herself, she could do it herself. Now she's 18, so I can't force her to go do anything that she doesn't want to do. So ultimately, she called me one day and said, yes, I'm ready. I need to be clean. I can't do this anymore. And I took her back to the emergency room. They admitted her to detox. And by the grace of God, there was a girl that worked at detox that got me an extension. The insurance was paying for 2 days. She got me an extension for 3 days. And in the meantime, she found a rehab out of state in Connecticut that would take her. There was no beds locally that she could have gone to in New York State. So she ended up going down to Connecticut. 30 days was the max that they would take her for. I am so off of what I was supposed to be talking about, but I'm sorry. 30 days was the max that they would take her for, and she got discharged after 30 days, and that day she relapsed. She relapsed, she was clean again for another 30 days, and she ended up relapsing again. She was with me. She had her room upstairs. I have a Cape Cod. And she told me to wake her up early in the morning. She wanted to take a shower. She wanted to get ready for work. And I went upstairs to wake her up, and she was already dead. That's nothing any parent should ever, ever, ever have to see. Parent, sibling, anybody. It's a nightmare that will never, ever, ever leave my mind. My daughter was brilliant. She was beautiful. She was funny. She had a million friends. She graduated high school at 16 with an advanced Regents diploma. She was absolutely, she was my nightmare, of course. She was a teenager, but she was a wonderful, wonderful person. And it shouldn't have ended this way, but it did. I'm sorry if I'm going off on this. She had her whole life ahead of her. She would have been standing here doing what I'm doing, because that's what she planned on doing when she was in rehab. I want to be able to counsel kids. I don't think the kids should have to go through this. I'll go back to my paper. I'm a retired Albany police officer slash detective. I never thought anything this horrific could ever happen to my baby's life, or mine and my family's for that matter. It is a living hell for the addict, their families, their friends, and I truly do not want to see this happen to their other families. The fact is that it is happening on a daily basis. And the fact that some people believe it is the addict's choice are completely wrong. And I've heard a lot of people say that. Contrary to this belief, the addicts hate themselves and do not want to use. But after using this drug for a very short time period, one time, two times, you're completely addicted and you have no way out. I mean, congratulations to you guys. I envy you, and congratulations, and just keep on the good path. I've spoken to a few high school classes about the heroin epidemic. The reception I received from the students, being a mom who lost her daughter to heroin, was astounding. The attention and respect they showed me was incredible. A teacher whose class I spoke to told me that he could have had all the police in the town speak about the effects of heroin, but coming from me made all the difference to the students. They felt my pain and my loss, and it really affected them. I feel there should be a new approach to prevention. This would include families, for example, parents, siblings, friends, all who have been affected, devastated, and destroyed by the death of their loved one. And I believe this should start in the middle schools and continue through to the high schools. There should be no boundaries for a heroin addict's recovery. When an addict is ready to get help and stop using, there has to be more rehabilitation facilities available without health insurance denials holding up their recovery. I had that issue, just like, I don't remember who said it, but she would have had to fail outpatient before they would take her inpatient, and that was one of the issues in New York. There was two doctors saying, no, they would not take her inpatient. The insurance wouldn't pay for it, I should say. We especially need more long-term facilities and aftercare as sober houses. When she did relapse, when she got out, she was headed for a sober house. The sober house, she didn't make it down there. And when she did get down there, the guy running the sober house said, we can't take her because she used. She relapsed. So that was the end of her sober house. But I was finding it difficult to find sober houses when she was released. New York State law enforcement should develop a heroin, I believe, New York State law enforcement should develop a heroin drug unit that would integrate investigators from all police agencies in New York State, including towns, cities, state police. This would give them the capability of crossing jurisdictions and be able to use their resources as a unit to track and prosecute the large suppliers. We should make available communication from the surrounding states and be allowed to follow through with them as well in order to put a stop to heroin highway. Being retired law enforcement, I know the restrictions that make the job of putting a case together against drug dealers a very difficult task. I believe that if law enforcement were given the ability to expand their jurisdictions when an investigation is warranted, they should have the freedom to do so they can follow the investigation to the end. The investigators would be able to arrest the middle to larger dealers. The dealers selling to support their own addiction, I don't believe, need to go to jail. I seriously need rehabilitation. I don't believe they belong in jail. And law enforcement personnel, prosecutors, they all know the difference. New York State had stricter laws to hold the dealers accountable, we wouldn't have to depend on federal prosecutors. New York State could prosecute these killers and send them to prison for a minimum of 20 years. We need stricter laws for the big suppliers. Currently, there is a proposed law in New York State legislation that would increase the penalty for the sale of heroin, which results in the death of another, to an A felony, which is a homicide charge, putting the dealer in prison for 25 years. This law would be dubbed Lurie's Law, after my daughter. Currently, the only charge in New York State is criminally negligent homicide that is an E felony with a penalty of up to 1 year in jail. This is not a deterrent to sell heroin in New York State. The heroin dealers already know they're not going to be held accountable for the death of others when they sell them heroin. When a heroin overdose death occurs, it should be treated as a crime scene, as if the death was from a gunshot. Prosecutors should be working together with law enforcement to bring the case to a successful conclusion. In 2015 New York State legislative session, there were 13 bills passed in the Senate dealing with heroin. The Assembly never even put them on the floor for a vote or even a debate. Sorry, gentlemen. So a year has gone by and nothing has been done in New York State to help with any of the issues involving the heroin and that are killing our families and or changing them forever. If it truly is a wording issue in some of the laws, which is what I heard last year, that became was an issue with the laws that were passed in the Senate, that there was wording issues when it came over to the Assembly, then can we please work on that and get these bills moving? The presidential debates that are currently taking place are even speaking of the opiate heroin epidemic problem throughout the country. If it has gone to that level, New York State should be acting so we stop losing our families. There should be a law in effect to track deaths specific to heroin. The statistics are not being properly recorded. Some list heart failure, combined pharmaceuticals, multiple drugs, accidental overdose. There needs to be consistency. The certificate should state that heroin was involved in the death so that an accurate measure of this epidemic can be reported. My baby girl is gone and nothing will ever bring Lurie back, but her family and friends will hurt and miss her forever. I feel Lurie's law would certainly make a difference in how the big suppliers feel about selling their poison in New York State. I'm aware that this will be a large endeavor, but the need has become so great to save our families because we are losing them to this epidemic at such a rapid rate, especially our children, and no one is being held accountable for their deaths.
Thank you, Patty.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any questions before I sit down?
We're going to be talking afterwards because the parameters have been set. Otherwise, we'll be here all night.
No, I'm sorry. I went over.
Okay.
No, that's
Thank
okay.
Thank you, Patty. Next, Matt.
Good afternoon. I'm here as a person in recovery. I'm a person that's been clean now for about 13 years. I'm local to the area. I have notes. I'm not checking the football score. And my story includes jails, dropping out of school, hospitals, multiple times in jail, and homelessness. And again, now I've been clean for 13 years. And I was a high school dropout. And through the recovery program and system and rehabilitation system, I was able to go get a GED and then go on to a two-year college. And then, you know, now actually I finally finished school. I have a master's degree now. So I went from being a person that took a lot of tax money, you know, more because of the countless incarcerations. Eventually, a major part of my recovery involved being, I was actually in the first graduating class of Albany County's felony drug court. And that's kind of how my process started. So it was interesting that treatment there, one crack at treatment, and I kind of, you know, muddled my way through it, but ultimately remained clean when there was probably about 15 incarcerations, averaging about 2 months, 3 months that were in the years prior to that. So drug court and diversion activities are definitely something that's important. The other thing I'd say, just other things that worked was just my peers, people that were around me that were also in recovery. Until I went to 12-step meetings, I never met a person in my life that was in recovery. I knew people that used drugs. I knew some people that didn't. A lot of that now, being a person that's in long-term recovery, and it's great to see so many people standing out, is that it's our obligation, I think, now to make sure that everybody knows that recovery is real and that recovery is possible. Also what helped me was education. You know, that's something that I really was able to focus on. Vested, I know that vocational services and different things like that are kind of a little bit different. I was in a rich vested time, and it was kind of easy. I mean, they paid for my school, my books, my everything. But to be honest with you, when I started school, like, drug court was the first thing I ever graduated. You know, again, I dropped out of high school. And when I first started going to school, it was just something that gave my life just a tiny, tiny, tiny bit of hope. Because, like the people that we're talking about today, I was a real drug addict. You know, I was somebody that sold stuff on the street. You know, I was somebody that didn't think I was going to be a drug addict. You know, I went to CBA. You know, I wear Abercrombie. You know, I'm from Bethlehem. You know, whatever it is, I'm not going to be a drug addict. But ultimately, I was a drug addict just like anybody else. But education really was something that was really important. And I think some other things that are important is the availability of medication-assisted treatment, which is a SAMHSA, evidence-based practice, which mostly, you know, we know about methadone from the past, but now mostly Suboxone. That's something that's evidence-based to definitely work and definitely help people gain on the journey to recovery. I know that HHS came out with an announcement this week saying that some regulations were being lifted, but it's still super, super hard for your average person to just be able to access it. And the other thing I just think, and we've heard a lot about today, is just payer reform. It's still so interesting that when I help people, you know, coworkers or whoever, try to get family members into treatment, it's so funny that it's not the family member, it's not the addict, it's not the doctor, the insurance company is still the one that for some reason, and I still don't get it, we did Timothy's Law, we've done all these other reforms, we had Obamacare, we've done all this, but somehow we're still here. Somebody today is probably going to die because yesterday their mom was told them that they're not going to be able to get treatment. So I'm really great to be here, and I just want to tell all the other people that are in recovery to just, you know, let your voice be heard because it's important that people know about us. Thank you.
I'm going to ask, thank you, Matt. I'm going to ask Father Young to say a couple of words.
Just 58 years ago, I was running a shelter down on the south end of Albany, and it was an adventure because almost all of the folk were addicted. They're alcohol, heroin. At that time, we called it the Harlem problem. We didn't call it the heroin problem. We called it the Harlem. And I was lucky because I grew up with a guy by the name of Harry Albright. Used to double date with him and had a lot of fun. And when he became appointments officer to the governor, I'd go up and have morning coffee with him all the time. And it was a great relationship. And every once in a while, Rocky dropped in and he said, I want to see what you're doing. You know, you're talking and I'm aware of what you're doing. And let me go down and take a look at what you're doing. So he came down to St. John's on Green Street in Albany. Now, if you're not from Albany, Albany has a Green Street that's well known. And at that time, it was an exciting experience, and he was going around looking at what we were doing. And Rocky said, here's the deal. We were cutting, we were in the dining room, and he cuts off the crust when he has sandwiches. And as he did that, he said, you know, I'll make a deal with you. I'll give you one bill, guarantee one bill a year. What do you need? I said, I need hospitals first, just what we're talking about. He said, I'll give you 19 of them, 60 beds apiece. Oh, thank you, Governor. Well, go around and tell them where you want it. I'll give you the letter. And I was like a kid in a candy store, developing then 19 hospitals on all the state property, all the mental hygiene offices. From that time on, it was happy. Every day, he would talk with me and chat with me. I'd have a parking place right next to his on the ramp. It was a joyful kind of life. Because I saw things done for the people that were needing it. They were doing it, and I put the bill in to decriminalize, Sheriff would know, 24040 in the penal code. That was the big bill. 35,000 meetings and 14 years of my life later, he signed the bill. That was great, because now we don't, as you were talking about it before, we don't stigmatize now. Before you had to say, I'm a criminal. Now you can say, I'm a person, I have a disease, I have an illness. That's the bill that made it, instead of don't incarcerate, rehabilitate, it made it not a crime but a disease. And therefore, women came out of the closet. They you know, when you'd go to an AA meeting in the late 50s, you wouldn't see too many women. Rare would you see a woman. Now you go to the fellowship and they're all over the place. And it's a wonderful thing because now they're coming out getting the kind of help they need. So I think we have to really kind of go for the PR approach. We have to look at what Rocky did. He did a lot of great stuff. I'm proud of what he did. I'm proud of what he has done. Because for every year, 10 years in a row, he gave me a major bill. I never had my name on it. I just put it into his program package. The big thing, we tried to do it after a while. We learned it quite quickly. Don't put it into program, put it into finance. And that was really a runner when we showed the economic kind of value. When I'm looking at the documentation for Rikers Island that I saw, I think, in the Times this past week, $200,000 a year per inmate, per person. Now, I know the sheriff will run a very economical kind of course there because we were out there. We had a program in his course in his institution a long time ago. And they're great programs. We have ASAT and ASAT programs, and we started that. And a very important thing is we had that. We had 41,000 in that program when I retired from prison. I was in prison for 34 years working with the inmates. In that prison period, the men came back, and I've got stigmatized the kind of information, the kind of good documentation, fingerprints. The fingerprints show that we had only 10% reincarceration for people who completed a stool of programs, treatment, housing, and employment. You have to get them a job, too. If you don't get them a job, they're back in the run. So I think it's important that you have to have that kind of stool, a three-legged stool kind of concept. And that's, to me, very vital. Jimmy knows about it because Jimmy was a great basketball player, better than Zeke Sitacola. He set the high school record. And I always upset with him, but tonight's my night to get even, Jim. But I'm just eager to be here, and I certainly thank you because you're keeping it up there, and I hope Heroin Highway, Route 4, Tony, you're going to be able to put something up there to stop it. And I'm happy to see all the white people here tonight because before they used to say it was a black problem. It's not a black problem. It's a white problem now because you have got the money.
Thank you, Father. Next, Sue Martin.
As organized as I'd like to be. Hi. My name is Sue Martin. I am a person in long-term recovery. I have 30 plus years in recovery. It does run in families. I have three loved ones in treatment at the moment. I am very blessed that they're in a long-term treatment program all 3 months long, and I'm very excited. My son got into treatment. My son started in his pathway into treatment by things spiraled out of control, and he admitted to me what was going on, and we got in the car and drove to St. Peter's as fast as we could. I knew St. Peter's would take care of him, and his insurance company sent him home to me in 3 days. I wrote them a letter, and I told them I don't know if his failure at outpatient is going to be an arrest, a car accident, an overdose, or a suicide attempt. It was an arrest. He's now a convicted felon, which he was not at the first time we brought him in. I'm a pharmacist. I'm 30 years sober. I have been paying my health premiums since I was 16. And he is covered under my insurance. He is under 26 years old, and he will be covered under my insurance until he is 26. So when they say the funding isn't there, I've been paying this funding my entire life, and when I needed the coverage, it wasn't there. His coverage is being paid for now. He is getting his coverage now because it's court ordered, and so the insurance company isn't denying it because he's got a court order behind him saying that he must do the treatment. He's getting wonderful care now, and he's in a long-term program. My niece was asking for help. We went through 3 different emergency rooms before she finally had a suicide attempt to get her get everyone's attention, the medical community, and she's in a long-term dual care program. But we got refused at 3 emergency rooms over 1 month before that happened. Her husband was also in trouble because it runs in couples too. And he was on waiting lists, and they told him just to use enough to get by until a bed opened. I'm a pharmacist. I've worked at Omnicare for years. I work with Conifer Park, and I work with Spark.
there's no magic ingredient at Conifer Park and Spark that isn't at every major medical center. They can all run a three-day detox, stabilize the person, and then send them on. They don't have to wait for the first detox bed. Glens Falls could have it. Champlain Valley Hospital could have it. Adirondack Medical could have it at Saranac Lake. I called all those places for my niece and her husband who were in the northern New York area. I had to drive 2 hours north from Saratoga, pick them up, and drive them down to either Conifer Park or Albany to St. Peter's in order to get them their initial detox so that then they could enter into a treatment program. It's everywhere. You can have Suboxone everywhere. You can have Clonidine everywhere. You can have Hydroxyzine everywhere. You can have fluid replacement and IV therapy everywhere. You don't need it only in those places, and I don't understand it. And that's my thing. Oh, and the way to stop the tide of drugs coming into this country is to stop the demand. Educate the young people, educate the families, get everyone's head out of the sand. If you stop the demand and improve the recovery, the drugs stop coming in.
Thank you. Keith Cole from Circles of Hope.
So my name is Keith Cole, and after hearing these people talk, I felt wasn't going to come up here and speak to you, but I felt it was necessary that I come up and say a few things. So I'm a little bit nervous just because I don't speak in front of people often. My wife and I own a small company in the Northeast here. We do intervention work. Okay, so we're not therapists, but we do a lot of intervention work, a ton of intervention work. And what we see constantly is insurance companies don't want to pay. I see families that mortgage their homes to send their children to treatment. And by the way, I work with mainly adolescents. And I do adult work as well, but just for speaking tonight, adolescence is kind of what we do. There is a big problem. We saw it about 3 years ago with heroin. We saw it down in New Jersey. We were getting a lot of work in New Jersey, and so we were seeing it. We were bringing kids to therapeutic boarding schools, residential treatment programs, wilderness programs out west. And mainly the reason is because parents didn't have the ability or the latitude, so to speak, to get help from the people who matter the most, which is you guys. I mean, you set the laws, you make the laws, and they were helpless. So they have to find other alternatives to help their children. And so what they do is they wind up without getting any help from insurance companies, because their insurance companies, believe me, they don't pay for nothing. So they wind up mortgaging their homes, or they take their money for their college funds and they put that to treatment. A 90-day program costs, in the beginning, about $30,000 to $35,000 out of pocket that the parents have to pay. It doesn't include transporting them out to wherever they're going. It doesn't include intervention services. And by the way, intervention services work. We've probably done over 2,000, and we're successful in every one of them because of our approach. And we know that treatment does help. We see the results all the time. So I think the thing that I'm telling you is that you know, parents are just frustrated. They love their children, and they can't get the help. And mainly because insurance companies will not pay for this. So if I leave here with any message to you guys, is to let you know that insurance companies aren't doing what they're supposed to do. You need to hold them accountable.
That's it. Thank you. Elise Ainsworth.
I just mentioned something before the next young lady speaks. I think it's clear to all of us up here that as we have these forums, we've got to have one forum at least where all the insurance executives are sitting up here answering the questions of why they're not providing the answers to these people. So I would highly recommend that as one of them, and I'm sure they're considering that, our two co-chairmen.
Thank you, Assemblyman. All right, Elise.
Hi, thank you for coming today. My name is Elise Ainsworth. I'm a young person in recovery. I'm a member of YPR, the Albany chapter. It's a non-for-profit organization. I volunteer my time. There's a lot of non-for-profit organizations out there. You know, people volunteer their time. We're building, helping, and maintaining the recovery community. To answer Al's question, what do we need? What tools we need? We need funding. My question is, when is the government going to take action? Like, it's great that we're here and we're saying all this stuff, but where's the action, really? You know, I guess that's my question. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Elise. And we will answer those questions. The panel will answer those questions. Next. We.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Can we have that discussion in the final 15 minutes?
Yeah. Thank you very much.
At that point, we can have that kind of debate. Right now, I'd like to hear the testimony. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next person is Angelina Hart.
While we're talking about insurance companies, I want to take a moment and ask you if you've heard of Kaiser Permanente's ACE study. For those of you that may not be familiar with this study, the ACE study looks at 10 risk factors that a child may face by the age of 18. For each of these risk factors, you get a score of 1. The higher the score, the worse things are. So what are these adverse childhood experiences? Psychological, physical, and sexual abuse. Physical and emotional neglect. And household dysfunction. The short litany is mental illness, domestic violence, parental separation or death, family incarceration, and substance abuse. A male child with an ACE score of 6 or more has a 4,600% increased risk of becoming an IV drug user. 25 years ago, I became a statistic of my own ACE score. I went from a straight A student to a strung-out junkie the second time I used heroin. How did this happen? I stand by my ACE score, which is not my destiny. As I stand here before you, I'm in long-term recovery. Sufficient at the age of 14, I wanted to die, and I nearly succeeded. I was, at the time, the youngest person admitted to the local mental health unit, and they did not know how to treat someone like me. There were new medications for someone as skinny as I was, as small as I was, and with the problems that I had, which were all based on my adverse childhood experiences. The trauma from these experiences affected the development of my brain. This is not theory, this is science. And as a result, I ended up addicted to heroin, because I assure you, a happy, well-adjusted person with a fully functioning brain doesn't just wake up one day and decide, oh, I'm going to try heroin. There is a brain dysfunction. When we talk about things like the amygdala got hijacked, this is what we're talking about. It's easy to see someone with a cast on their arm to know that the arm is broken and not working, but we don't wear casts on our brains. I stand clearly behind science on that. So within 2 months of using heroin, I ended up homeless on the Avenue B side of Thompson Square Park on a bench, doing shameful things to support my habit. And my life was pretty much over at that point. If you want to talk to me about the horrors of my experience, I'll be happy to share that afterwards. The recovery process for me, peer support was very helpful. I strongly support that. It was life-changing for me. I don't think that criminalization is the answer, because when I look at those 10 risk factors, six or more of which increases the likelihood of another IV drug addict, most of those can be attributed to an incarcerated parent, because the other parent might be stressed out, working a lot of jobs, screaming at the child, unable to spend time with the child. The child feels neglected, abandoned. There's a lot of other issues that can arise. Food insecurity, because there isn't enough money because the bread earner or one of the people contributing to the household is in jail. I don't think this is the answer. Just like I didn't have a bad parent, I had a parent who was ill-equipped to raise me. I'm not a criminal, but I engaged in criminal behavior as a result of my addiction. So, in closing, somebody said it much better than I can. It was Dr. Vincent Felitti, who was the lead author of the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study, states, if you were to ask me what my thoughts are on the most effective public health advance that I can think of in current times, I would say to figure out how to improve parenting skills across the nation. So as the coordinator for the New York State Parenting Education Partnership, when I asked my employer, Prevent Child Abuse New York, permission to publicly speak and bring in my employer into this conversation, and was told that I am valued and still have a job, I was blown away and moved to tears, because for many people still, the stigma means that they would not have a job or would lose their community standing. So I thank you very much.
Darla Joette.
Hello, my name is Darla Jowett. I am a representative of the Naranon Group in Delmar, New York, I'm nervous, sorry. I've been up here about 7 years from New Jersey, and I started going to the Naranon Group immediately in Colony, because my son is my addict. He's been an addict for about 9 years. Became one after having his wisdom teeth out and being given oxycodone, massive amounts of it, and he was already kind of a partier with alcohol and pot, and so as soon as he got his hands on that drug, it was over. And then he had another friend who said, geez, you know, that's really expensive, why don't you try this? Heroin, $10 a bag, right? So that was it. So 9 years ago, he was basically shooting up heroin. And like many of us, I had no clue, because heroin addicts can cover this up very well. showing up at family, you know, holidays, and having had a fix, they appear perfectly normal. So anyway, finally he was arrested for breaking into homes nearby, stealing television sets, and then fencing them in Atlantic City. So my husband and I at the time, actually he was my ex-husband, ended up spending a fortune on a lawyer just to get him a lesser sentence. He did end up going to jail for probably 6 to 8 months, came out and went right to rehab. He's been in and out of rehabs 4 times. The last one, and this is all in New Jersey, and I apologize for that. This, I don't have a lot of information about New York, but in New Jersey, basically all 4 rehabs were paid for. We didn't have to pay for them. I think the first one had to do with the fact that with DUIs, they have to pay fines, and the fines go into some kind of a bucket fund that then are used to pay for people's rehab who can't afford it. So anyway, I'm trying to make a long story short. Eventually, he went into the longest term he was able to get was 90 days. Came out of there, and he was clean for 5 years. He got his girlfriend pregnant. She's also a heroin addict. At the beginning of that 5 years, and fatherhood seemed to be something that put him on the straight and narrow. He did very well. He had a job that paid about 60 grand. He was doing really well, staying clean, still paying, you know, probation fines and all that stuff. But and then in April of this year, he ended up in the hospital. I didn't hear from him for 3 days, and he was in New Jersey. And I had to get my ex-husband involved to go to his apartment. I had to call the apartment building people to say, you know, open the door, call the cops, there's something wrong. Because I have a very close relationship with my son. And I hadn't heard from him for 3 days. So they go there, and my ex-husband goes there, and he calls me from the door, which is open this much because the chain is still on there. He says, well, the good news is he's still alive. I can see his chest moving on the couch. So ambulance came, took him, and my husband's ex-husband's calling me from behind the ambulance, you know, and I'm leaving here to drive down to Cooper Medical to see, and I don't know if he's going to be alive or dead when I get there. But my calmness, I have to say, was because of my years in Narnon. And if anyone here has families that need this kind of support, please send them to a Narnon group. There's 4 of them up here now. It's really the only way I made that drive for 3.5 hours without killing myself and other people. So anyway, that's mostly what I wanted to say about that. I also have an addicted stepdaughter who's up here, who just came through the Next Step program. And it's awesome. It's just an awesome program. She's doing great. And if you can throw more money at that, that would be a huge, huge blessing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councilman Jim Gordon.
Thank you. And to stay on point, I'm just going to read from some prepared remarks. Most of my remarks revolve around the toll it takes on the community, drugs and violence, should I say. As mentioned, my name is Jim Gordon. I'm a councilman here in Troy. The issue and topic before us continues to grow and creep throughout our communities, bringing with it death and destruction. We have a gang and drug-related violence issue on our streets. In our city over the past several years, we have watched a ripple grow into a tsunami wave. As I mentioned, this epidemic is not unique to Troy. Locally, we witness activity among rival gangs in Albany, Schenectady, and Troy, and even in Saratoga. The individuals battle over a host of issues, much related to turf, respect, but ultimately a lot to do with drugs. In our communities, we have endured this eruption of violence. In Troy, over the previous 21 months, we've had 70 shootings, resulting in 31 victims. Death and wounded have resulted. Many victims in their early to late teens. many with criminal rap sheets that demonstrate a life of criminal activity. While the victim slash offender relationship in the majority of these shootings is known, these acts of violence often occur in broad daylight on busy streets where stray bullets narrowly miss bystanders. It's also worth noting that just this past August, while responding to a reported carjacking, two of our Troy police officers were shot and wounded by an individual who was suspected to being under the influence of an illegal substance during the shootout. The violence on our streets has a direct connection to gangs and the drug trade in our region. This can be highlighted by the recent results of a joint investigation by numerous law enforcement agencies and the New York Attorney General's office entitled Operation Trojan Horse. What resulted were 20 arrests, many of whom were Troy-based gang members of the Young Guns gang, seizure of 100 grams of cocaine and more than 100 bags of heroin, prescription drugs, and a number of illegal firearms. Unfortunately, as we've witnessed after these arrests, the violence and the trade continues because there's always individuals looking to fill the void, and there is a lapse in our criminal justice system. It is a revolving door issue, this battle. Many residents are losing hope, and frustration in our neighborhoods is overwhelming. We not only have to deal with the violence spurred by this gang and drug activity, but as some mentioned tonight, our community has to deal with the family, friends, neighbors, coworkers, etc., who fall victim to the addiction of heroin and prescription drugs. These forms of addictions not only do not segregate to status and income levels, they are community destroyers, and unfortunately, locally, we have lost too many lives to addiction and these overdoses. And anecdotally, if I can add, in preparation of this evening, in conversation with members of our community and those in first responding positions, this past week in the city of Troy, they believe they had 3 deaths due to some form of substance overdose. Much needs to be done to reform and improve our system of evaluation, treatment, and punishment of those who continue to treat the criminal justice system as a revolving door, selling one day, in court the next, back on the street the following day. People don't become addicts because they choose to become addicts, like many speakers have said. They can become addicts because someone offered them an opportunity, but however, people continue to offer that opportunity. That's where we need, and I was pleased to hear the undersheriff say we need a full court press from law enforcement, but we also need support within our criminal justice system. Because there are people who aren't addicts who are pushing to people who are addicts. So thank you for the opportunity to speak, and thank you for your attention to this matter, because it's well reaching into our communities and causing many, many heartache that isn't necessary. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember. Christina Mahanley.
Some help. I have a 32-year-old daughter who is a heroin addict. She has a 2-year-old son. She's been an addict, I'm assuming, before she had the baby. I have tried everything I can possibly do to protect my grandson, to get my daughter into rehab. I keep getting roadblock after roadblock after roadblock. She's an adult. She makes her own decision. It's her choice. She tests clean when we go to the court. She's lived with me. She's currently living with her grandparents. They watch the baby. They're in their 80s, mid-80s. She uses that child as a weapon. You'll let me do this or I'm taking my son and I'm going to live in a shelter. I am asking for some assistance. I need to know where to go, what to do. I don't know what to do, and I'm at a loss. I need to protect my grandson. They will be living on the streets shortly, or with other heroin addicts. He's only 2 years old, and who protects the babies? You know. And I guess that's just my story.
Are you asking what you can
do? I'm begging.
Have you petitioned the court for custody?
I was in court in January. The CPS, they found that, yes, she tested positive. And then when we went into court, the judge had made her go take another test right then and there. And she tested clean, but, you know, I know there's stuff that you can take to test clean for a urine test, you know. She was gone an hour and 15 minutes. She had plenty of time to, you know, she had tested a couple of times with someone else's urine. They knew that. And yet when the judge said, okay, she tests clean, case is dismissed, she, you know, it's her son. She can do whatever she wants. The police have recently been called several times. She's stolen the car, and they said, well, what do you want us to do? She probably needed a fix. And she had my grandson in the car in the middle of the night. And that was their answer. They said, there's nothing we can do. She's an adult. She can do whatever she wants. It's her child. If she wants to go live in the street, it's her choice.
She can't endanger the child, though.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't know what police department this is.
Call
your local representative. Call your local county representative, right, when it comes to that.
She can't endanger the child.
Well, yeah.
There's no way that can happen. I'm not sure who you've talked to, but...
It has happened. I'm telling you it has.
Please, thank you very much. Who did you talk to?
I went through Schenectady County CPS.
And they
Glenville Police, she came home. She's been cut under her throat. She's been cut on her leg.
She's had the child with her.
She does take the child, yes, but they can't catch her.
Can't prove it?
They can't catch her at that time, so we had a birthday party for my grandson.
Did they ever assign her a case number? I mean, a case number to that case CPS?
When we were in court, but then when the judge said she's clean, everybody's free to go, case is dismissed.
So there was no individual CPS investigator part of that then?
There was. Her name was Anna.
How much did she do before
she
got out of court?
She investigated and found that, yes, Tammy was a heroin addict. But when we got into court, the judge tested her and she came back clean and they said okay.
Judge ignored CPS's report?
She's just been arrested August 1st for a controlled substance. It's been postponed again today. This is the second time it's been postponed. She goes again in 2 weeks, and she's probably going to be dismissed on that one, too. How do you get a person who doesn't want help? And how do you protect the children? Mm. Who protects my grandson?
That's a good question. CPS should be protecting your grandson. That's kind of a basic. What you got the march money.
Well, one of the things we're looking at, just to let you know that not to do that, is we're looking at Florida has a statute called the Marchman Act. And the Marchman Act would actually let family members, you know, petition the court if a person, and it treats drug addiction differently than we're doing it now, that they're a danger to themselves and danger to others, and it would allow the court to force a person into rehab. Okay, so that's one of the things we're looking at. The other thing that we're looking at is on a criminal side, if a person comes in with a opium or opiate-based or heroin, you know, part of his crime had to do with heroin, is that that person is held without bail to undergo an evaluation. This is one of the other things we're looking at. And what would happen is part of the bail conditions, if the person wanted to go on bail, is that they participate in a rehab program. And if they don't do it, then these are one of the things that we're going to be suggesting.
But that's just things that are
right
in the works. What is in the works right now that I can do to protect my grandson?
Well, right now you have CPS, and you have the county district attorney's office, and you should be writing to them and talking to them, because they're the ones that can force this, and whoever your legislative person is, if it's a town police department or county police department, you want to get your legislator involved. Whether it's a town, if it's a town police department, you want to talk to the town. If it's a county police department, you want to talk to your county legislator and let him advocate for you with the police department or wherever else if they feel that the police department isn't doing what they're supposed to do. But if a person's driving under the influence of a narcotic and you have a child in the car, that falls under Leandra's law. And, you know, the person should be arrested for that, especially for having a child in the car while they're driving under the influence. So, you know, I don't know what the story is with your police department or what district attorney's office have you contacted them?
I haven't contacted a district attorney's office.
But there are laws in place, and you're going to have to, you know,
speak out.
There
are. The Glenville police were at the house when the grandparents called and said, you know, she disappeared with our great-grandson, and she's driving a car. We didn't give her permission, and the only thing they said they could do was to either have her arrested for car theft or she can do what she wants. She's the mother.
Well, these are some of the things we're looking to fix, to give parents and family members tools in order to, but right now, talk to us afterwards, and we'll see what we can.
I'll talk to you afterwards, too.
Yeah, one of the things I'd like to ask for Christina is just some of our experts here could maybe huddle up afterwards and brainstorm this a little bit. And, you know, we certainly have some nods of acknowledgement that we can get that to happen with some of our folks here that, you know, we're looking at things, but none of that's in place yet. So we need immediate action. And I think one of the things that your daughter's probably not at that point where she's not asking for help, and that's a real problem. Right. So that makes it a little more difficult, but it doesn't make it impossible. And Leandra's law, things like that can come into play. But I think brainstorming a little bit afterwards with some of our experts will be hopefully give you some more insight.
Thank you.
Somebody check, but this year in Children and Families, Donald Lepardo, who was the chairman of the assembly, there were big problems in Erie County. And similar to what you're talking about, where there was a complaint made and nothing was followed up on. So I believe there's a 1-800 number you can call in that case to the state's Children and Family Services, Social Services. They're trying to check what that legislation was. I only have a vague memory of it. I'm so sorry. But there are options out there. If you're not satisfied with CPS is doing in your county, call the state, okay? And explain to them what's happened. What would that trigger is somebody looking into the situation as it happened. So then they would be able to look at the record of your complaints or whomever's complaints and your daughter's history with CPS up to that date. That would put a whole new fresh set of eyes on it, and that would be very helpful to you. There's nothing, I don't know what else to tell you. It's kind of heartbreaking, but that's what I would do and as an immediate, because your concern is immediate and your concern for your grandson is immediate.
Absolutely.
I understand that. And, you know, people will use children as a weapon. People love them, and they'll use love as that weapon.
Yes.
So what you need to do is in your fear, I wish I had something better to tell you, but that's what I would do. I would look up the 1-800 number for Child Protective Services at the state level.
I feel that CPS did do their job.
Well, then it's the courts. I see you've got, again, things here that as we're looking at these issues.
We're going to get folks afterwards that are going to work with you specifically.
Yeah.
So
thank you
and we appreciate your. Janice McGuire.
First of all, for allowing us the opportunity to tell you all our stories and to offer some suggestions. I have three things. I could probably stand here and repeat a lot of the stories that most of the moms here have shared. I've been through all of it, as have probably all the mothers and fathers here, in terms of the Narcan, the release from the hospital after a Narcan recovery, the having to allow the legal systems to take over to allow our children to get access to treatment. We've been through it all, and my friends from Family Anonymous that are here with me have also shared those experiences. But I have three things that have come up over and above, or in addition to, I should say, the what's been discussed today that I thought I should bring up and share with you my thoughts on. The first one is access to treatment, and I just want to throw out something, and I'll do that in a minute, which is probably a fairly contradictory, or not necessarily contradictory, but questionable thought process that I've had based on some professional experience that I have that keeps coming up. Second thing is, after access to treatment, it's access for the recovering addict for socialization skills and rebuilding their life once they're in recovery, because I have personal experience with that having been a problem as well. And the third one is access to information for families, and I know that has already come up. I'll address the easiest one first. I share with what's come up here a few times is the first time that we were exposed to my son's heroin addiction, and having been exposed to things like drug court and all the terminology that came out through the legal system. I remember my ex-husband at the time saying, I hate knowing all about the system. I hate knowing every bit of this. But just not even knowing what Troy Drug Court was, or how it was going to affect my son, I thought it was a horrible thing. And in retrospect, it turned out to be probably the reason he's still alive today. Families have no idea where to turn. There needs to be some resource on what are your legal rights. I love the thought that we could eventually maybe remand them to some sort of a program and be allowed to do that. My son was 22 or 23 by the time we were really able to get a grasp on what was going on. But we need to be able to have some sort of a repository of information, a way to navigate the system, understanding for families what can they do, what can't they do, what are the resources available for the addict, what are the resources available for the family. I mean, it has affected, devastatingly affected my entire family. And I'm sure everybody's family here. And there just has to be some way of teaching people how to navigate the system. And that's the easiest one of what I'm going to talk about. The second thing is something that I didn't think I was going to have to address. We've been lucky enough, or had been lucky enough, that my son had a long-term addiction. I had to let the legal system get involved in order to get him treatment, because a guardian angel in the drug court finally said to me, let us take over. You're not going to get him. I couldn't get him into treatment. And she said, just let me get him into the system, and then I'll get him into inpatient. And she did, and she saved his life. And her exact words were, I'm not going to let him die on my dime. And she got him into treatment, and the program was, there were just so many angels throughout the way, and he spent 15 months in recovery and did phenomenal and was a changed human being. And then he got out, and within a week of being out of drug court, a week, actually I should say 6 days, he was so upset about the fact that he had dug such a deep hole for himself. He couldn't, he knew he had no job that he could get that was going to be able to yield him enough income to be able to get himself out of the situation he was in. He had devastated so many relationships and had spent a lot of time rebuilding them, and we were on a good path, and he relapsed and overdosed and drove his car headfirst into a tree. And just an observation, he's alive. He's remarkably uninjured because of his overdose, and thank God for Narcan. But interestingly, when we went through it, and this was just very, very recent, two things that happened that I'm just going to make an observation on, because I thought they were, I don't know really what to make of them, but one was that throughout the entire process, all they kept saying to me is, he's so lucky to be alive. Oh, what was it, heroin? And then they would look at his chart. And everybody that came in and talked to him about it, very matter-of-factly, the entire hospital staff, the police, the EMT, everybody. Oh, it was heroin. The nurses were saying things to him like, how long you been on it? Geez, you know, you got a great family here. You really should watch out. Well, he walked out of that hospital that night with two tickets for veering right off the road and going onto somebody's property. Nothing drug-related at all. So there will be no repercussions from this from a drug perspective, just the insurance perspective. And when we left, the ED physician looked at me and said, you do have Narcan at home, right? I said, oh, yeah, I do. So that was just an interesting observation. But the third thing is something that is going to be probably controversial thought, but it occurred to me as we were sitting here. I run a very large medical practice in the area, and we treat people for a disease that has no cure. And we treat people with biologic drugs that are infused on a regular basis. And I've done this for many, many years and been in this industry, and I've worked for industry for many years, pharmaceutical industry, prior to this. And I spend an enormous amount of my staff's time getting access to treatment, funding for people, either through the insurance companies or through the pharmaceutical companies or through foundations or everybody. I find every resource that we can to get these people on treatment for their autoimmune diseases, because they have to stay on their maintained treatment every 4 weeks or every 6 weeks on an infusible drug in order to be able to pay for their treatment, because there is no cure to give them a quality of life to live. And we get treatment from a lot of resources. And the insurance companies have limited and reduced periodically, regularly over the years, have reduced our access to their reimbursement. And it's understood, and I'm certainly not, believe me, I am not an advocate for the insurance companies, and I totally understand the frustration, and I have shared it as well. I had to put my son on Medicaid in order to get him treatment. But with the Affordable Care Act and the requirements on the insurance companies, and with all of the really expensive biologic drugs for either chemotherapy or for autoimmune diseases or now for neurology and for urology and all the ones that are out there and the demands that are being placed on the insurance companies, I think expecting them to pay is just it's a dream. It's not going to be the reality. It's getting blood from a stone. The insurance companies aren't the route to go. I think we should put pressure on them to find pressure, to find funding for them. But I'm not necessarily sure that's going to yield us what we need in terms of being able to get people access to treatment for this. So I would propose that we would go back to the source, industry, pharmaceutical companies, and I know none of you want to be the person who has to go up against industry. I understand the implications of that, but I'm just offering that as an outside-of-the-box thinking for funding for this, because insurance companies are never going to be able to find the funding for it.
Thank you.
So. Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to speak.
Okay, next we're going to hear from Kara Van Gilder, and then we're going to hear from Art Frost. So Kara first.
Hello. Sorry, it's not a formal speech, as I just found out about it about a half an hour before I came here. So my name is Kara. I'm an individual studies major here, as well as a student senator, very active on campus. But addiction has really played a factor in my life. My sister is currently in shock treatment program. I'm sorry. And has been an addict for over 5 years. She's currently 23 years old. This has dramatically affected my life. Around the age of 15, she broke her knee and was introduced to oxycodone pills. From there, just 6 months after that, when the opiates ran out, she turned to heroin. She spent the past year and a half at Albion Correctional Facility. I only had the will to go twice during that whole time. The first time was I had to leave because I couldn't stop crying, and then the second time she actually asked me to leave because I couldn't stop crying. She's been to rehabs countless times, Conifer Park. Nothing has seemed to help. She just doesn't want to help herself. She's lied, stole, manipulated. Before being released in Albion, I was really stressed out, and I'm a full-time student, so here I am trying to develop a successful after plan for her so that I don't have to face all the stress. I I talked to my therapist, and my therapist thought this would be a great idea to try to come up with an after plan, but don't put all the pressure on myself. So I spoke to her on the phone 2 weeks before she was released from Albion Correctional Facility, and she cried in silence. And I said, "Amber, what's wrong?" And she said, "I'm afraid to come out. I don't know what's going to happen." The next day, I called the parole officer. I talked to my mom, and my mom gave me the number. So I Googled the phone number for the parole officer. They were no help. I told the parole officer that it wasn't a good idea to come back to our house. My mom lives in Queensbury. We live near Route 149, which is Heroin Highway. So her access to drugs is pretty easy. I moved down here because it was so hard during her addiction. I had to get out in order for me to be successful and not be surrounded by that. The parole officer was no help. There was no after plan. She relapsed the day that she got out of Albion Correctional Facility. While she was home for the 3 week period before she had to go back, she told me that she got high every day while she was in prison. Someone on her floor or her unit had a prescription for Xanax, a highly addictive anxiety medication, which she is still addicted to now. Why was this happening? Why did she have access to Xanax? It's hard for me to face this epidemic as I've never done drugs. Where's the help? Why wasn't parole keeping her on track? How can she be successful when she gets out of incarceration? It's a cycle. She comes out, she goes back in. She's addicted. I don't know what to do, and it's just, my mom is in complete denial. It's just too hard for her. So thank you for allowing me to share. It's short compared to others, as it's very hard for me to tell this story.
Thank you. Art Frost.
Good evening. My name's Art Frost, and like Sandy, like Ms. McCarthy, I'm a public attorney as well. I work in the public defender's office. I've been there for about 13 years now. I think Sandy will tell you the same thing I'm going to tell you. Councilman Gordon talks about the violence and the shootings and the gangs, and he's right. There is a sinister element to all of this. But there's more than that. The epidemic that we have, particularly with heroin, it affects every aspect of our communities. Assaults, petty larcenies, criminal mischiefs, burglaries. Not the burglaries that you think of with the scary guy with the mask, but the young kid who kicks in a door and grabs a laptop and runs out. That young kid is looking at 15 years in prison. Why isn't he going to treatment? We have a drug court in Troy, one in county court, one in city court. Our county court drug court judge is a wonderful lady, Judge Young. She's doing a great job. She's bemoaning the fact that she doesn't have enough people there. It's not because there's less drugs. It's not because there's less crime. It's because we can't get the people in there. That young kid that I just told you about that kicks in the door, he's not going to drug court. He's going to prison. We have one in city court. It's overwhelmed. I happen to cover a rural area of Rensselaer County, Averill Park, Sand Lake, Post and Kill. The heroin there is astounding. These kids, they don't get to drug court because our city drug court is overwhelmed. So where do they go? They get probation, they get community service, they get drugs. That's what they do. They go back out and they start using drugs again. We don't have a mechanism to get them where they need to be. I'm representing two people right now. One's a young man, 18 years old, never been arrested. He has a felony indictment, 6 counts, 3 sales, 3 possessions. He's not going to drug court. He's going to prison. He's 18. He has a small child. He has no job. And now he's going to be a felon. Where's he going except back on the streets? I have another man, mid-30s, married, wife, two kids, good job. He's an addict. He's not going to drug court. You want to know why? Because he's a first-time offender and he's only committed a C felony. See, if he commits a B felony, I can get him into drug court. But if he commits a C felony, because he's an addict, a user, not a dealer, he doesn't go to drug court. He goes to prison. How much sense does this make?
Thank you. Next, we're going to have Hannah Bishop, and then we're going to have Joseph LaCopola.
Hello. My name is Hannah Bischoff. I work at Conifer Park. I am an addiction tech there, which is, some people say front lines, some people say low man on the totem pole. I say privileged to work with people who need someone who to work with them every single day. I have been at Conifer Park for 6 years now, and to say it's been a privilege baffles most people. But it's also been an education, and it's been very troubling to watch this develop, because I've watched it develop over the last 6 years. There are 3 points that you asked that we speak on: prevention, treatment, recovery. And I have some notes for that. But there's this fourth thing that I have been struggling to name. Pre-treatment, I don't know, it's awkward. We don't have to reinvent the wheel with this, people, because this is not a Schenectady problem. This is not an upstate New York problem. This is not a United States of America problem. This is a global issue. And if you look around to see what other countries have done, they haven't fixed it, but they have definitely made steps in certain directions that have helped people who are involved in this disease of addiction. So do your research, people. Look at what's working. Why is it working? Start implementing the things that work. Not necessarily the things that are popular, not necessarily the things that get you reelected, but the things that actually help people. Because that's what we're talking about here, people. When I was in high school, there was this program, and I decided, because it would look good on my college, you know, transcripts, I joined it, and that was my beginning into learning about the disease of addiction. They trained high schooler students to go and teach sixth graders about addiction, about drugs, about what they would do to you. That program stopped in my town. That program was pushed out by the police program, because police officers are so much more well-respected than peers. That was somebody's really good idea, and to be honest with you, it didn't work very well. It was never a very popular program. The acronym was PUSH, Prevention Using Student Help. And what that program also did for me was opened up a family discussion. Because there's addiction in my family that we didn't talk about. What we did then, and we talked about why making good choices at that point in high school as a 10th grader was really important. So other things about prevention, Absolutely. Kids can reach kids. You just have to educate them. But I love this idea of incorporating people who have firsthand experience with addiction. I think that's powerful. And you know what? Shoot, bring in the law enforcement too, because they've got a story to tell with it as well. I think we need more people at the table, not less, not one person pushed out for another, but more teamwork approach to this. It's already been mentioned, but it's on my list, so here you go. Look at the prescribed opioids issue. Look at it. Look at the high addiction risk. Look at the actual efficacy of this, of these meds. What you'll find, I hope, can be the beginning of change with that. Treatment. I've had discussions just this past week with the other people that are working in my field, and we were talking about these no-fail programs. You don't get kicked out of the program because you mess up. Guess what? Relapse is part of a lot of people's story in recovery. So penalizing someone out of a program because they mess up, that's not setting anyone up to succeed in that program. More access sooner. It's been said, but I'm repeating it. Recovery. Support, support, support. I tell my patients all the time, give yourself your first 6 months. Your brain needs your first 6 months to heal. Discover what your new normal is. There's a lot of research going behind those 6 months. There's a lot of healing that can happen depending on how they use those first 6 months. And I'll wheel it back again to the reinventing the wheel thing. There's a lot out there. There's 12-step programs. There's rational recovery programs. There's all these things that can help. But we don't, the way the system is right now, we're not setting people up to even get that far. So more sooner is the key. All this, I probably should have started with this, the dangers of isolation. I think everything, every point that I've made has to do with interacting, working together, team effort, more people getting more interested in other people. Because when you talk about the root of this issue, isolation, it's the friend of the disease, but is not the friend of the solution. So keep doing this. Keep getting more minds, more ideas, because it's not by one person's mind that this is solved. We're all stronger when everyone works together. So keep it up. Thanks.
Thank you. Just in the interest of time, we have about six more people. I would like to encourage folks so that everyone can share. Limit your remarks to 3 minutes, please. Joseph LaCopola is next, and then Yeffie Mason.
Good evening, and thank you for this opportunity this evening. We've heard a lot from the speakers in regards to this disease of opioid addiction, and three things we need to look at really quickly. And we heard this evening, we want to look at prevention, education, and treatment. And one thing we didn't hear tonight, and I want to talk a little bit about, and I'll do it very quickly, is treatment, but treatment with medication-supported recovery. And we have 50 years of scientific evidence and studies that have shown the effectiveness of medication-supported recovery. That is with methadone, that is with Suboxone, and Vivitrol. We have to be open and willing to be able to use the tools that we have in our toolbox to be able to address this disease of opioid addiction. We have to fight the stigma associated with it. How quickly do we run underneath the table when we see communities run underneath the table when we say we're going to look at integrating medication-supported recovery in our treatment programs with the use of methadone and or Suboxone and or Vivitrol? How quickly do we run? And what are we running away from? Our neighbors, our children. were refusing their right to have medication-supported recovery and treatment. And when we say medication-supported recovery, it's not for everybody. It's what's appropriate. And what we have to look at with medication-supported recovery and the importance of that, and let's be very clear, it is not just giving someone a medication. It's encouraging, it's ensuring that they're engaged in treatment. Because our ultimate goal with the use of medication is get to the point to abstinence. It's to get the individual comfortable enough to be able to engage in treatment so that we can work with them and hopefully where they're no longer using medication as anyone with a disease, any physical ailment. That's our goal, but if not, to support them and say it's okay to use medication support recovery. How ridiculous was it in New York State that we had to put a bill in the Assembly, in the Senate, that was just recently signed by the governor, and thank you to the Assembly members here, in regards to the use of medication-supported recovery in our drug courts. How horrible was it that individuals in some drug courts were told to get off a medication that was working for them so they could participate? We now have a bill that was signed by our governor on the 25th that now makes it a law that if it's appropriate to continue to use that medication, they should be on that medication, and if it's appropriate, refer them to it. Finally, we need the support. Medication-supported recovery, the support of opening and integrating OTPs in the community. It's necessary. No one should be required to drive 2 to 3 hours to receive treatment and receive medication. It's unethical. Individuals should be able to get medication-supported recovery in the community they reside in. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Mr. Mason is going to come. You're welcome.
Hi, my name is Y.R.F. Mason, also in recovery, and congratulations. Just a brief summary about myself, right? In 1982, I got released from jail. 15 days later, I was back going up north. And I'm saying that to say, I got out in 86, got introduced to Father Young program, working with that three-legged stool, and haven't been back since. I'm currently roughly 2 months, 3 months before getting my 350 hours to get my KSAC-T. In other words, I'm saying that to say that recovery works, all right? I, too, wear a lot of hats. I'm also involved with Belvedere of Albany, working with people with traumatic brain injuries. Again, got introduced by Father Young with that. I didn't have time to write a whole lot of things, but I just want to go with what calculated in my mind. We're trying to get recovery inside the communities. I understand the lady talk about that Heron Highway. In class, we're talking about a lot about that. Further up north, they have implemented peer activist group. And I said that to say because a lot of times, especially juveniles, don't want to get involved with recovery. They don't want to be isolated in a facility where that they can get the help they need. However, this program that I'm understanding about allows people in recovery, such as myself and people who's clean, to go to them. When they need support, and this just food for thought for all your councilmen there, if there's some way that we can get help to people that need it, try to implement something like that. Because a lot of times, people in homes, and I understand the families here, and I empathize and sympathize with people who lost people using drugs, find a way, because they can't say I need help to the parent. They might be abusing their parents or something because they're using and fighting with themselves that they can't get help. And if they implement that the parents see they need help, call up these peer activist groups because most likely they can identify or another addict can identify with what they're going through because it's a lot of shame too. Even if they're using, they're ashamed, they're afraid, they're scared. even to their parents. And I'm learning this stuff day to day. The gentleman talked about detox. Detox should not be a dying sentence, because somebody, I understand that you have to be like basically dead to get into detox today. People should be allowed into detox, get the help they need, and also have a referral continuous plan after they're out of detox. Because I understand once you're out of detox for those 3 days, you're just released. There is Suboxone, there is methadone program. They should have some kind of implementation for a referral to continue their help to stay clean and sober, or to meet the needs that they need to stay stable. Because if they don't get these medications like Suboxone or methadone or whatever they use, they're going to go back out there and pick up again and use drugs. So I'm down at the end here. And also, you talked about the insurance companies, right, and pharmaceutical people. Now, if y'all been listening to the news, there's a 32-year-old man who made this pill for cancer that killed cancer, and this pill was like $1,700 for one. They need to also implement, because recovery is a disease, should be treated such as a cancerous disease. Put the attention on recovery, or that recovery affects people with depression, bipolar, and a lot of different mood swings. They should treat that as it's a cancerous disease. When they go into detox or some kind of emergency room, because they, and I'm also trainer, have been trained on the Narcan system, so I carry that in my car in case I'm in an environment where that someone overdose, I know how to use that. But going back to say that they should treat addiction as a disease, which it is, such as they do people with cancer or any diabetics or life-threatening disease. Instead of just undermining it, that treatment helps, and it does, and rehab and all those things, they should put the issue in there. When someone go into a facility or detox or something, they should be treated until that person is either has got some stability or some place where that they can go and get the help they need. Okay?
Thank you.
And I'm going out on the limb real quick. One more last thing to say that we watched this film, right? If you guys been over to Canada, there's a place downtown Canada that's real interesting to me, because I think this would be great. If we can't find this, which is hard to get a cure, but if people are going to use it, and we can't continue to stop people, have a place where that they can return their needles, they can trade off. In other words, just have a place. If you're going to use and you're going to continue to use, we're going to use in this place here, but there's going to be a detox in that facility where that when you get tired of using, only thing you have to do is just walk upstairs. And I seen this film, and the guy said it's still there today over in Canada. They doing that. I mean, like, if we can stop it, we can stop it. We're going to do our best to try to do it. But it's also a preventative method that we can use, where that if they don't stop using, just use less. Thanks. Thank you.
Okay, we've got three people left, and I'm going to say their names, and they're going to speak for 3 minutes each, and then we're going to hear a few things from our panel, and then we're going to say goodnight. Michael Kennedy first, Esther DeMico second, and Jennifer Haggerty third.
Thank you all. Michael Kennedy. I don't have any prepared statement, just having listen to these people, I decided to get up. As a follow-up to Mr. Graff's earlier comments, that there are three steps to recovery. There's the detox, there's the inpatient, 28 to 90 days, but then there's the bigger part, that's returning back to society and living your life clean. And it's this third step that I'd like to address. There are certain drugs, one of the other speakers just spoke about it, that can help an addict stay clean. Methadone. The person gets high on methadone. There's Suboxone. Suboxone is a drug that these addicts will abuse. They will take it when they want to take it, and they will sell it on the street when they want money. There's a third drug, which I find very frustrating, that's not available, and it's called Vivitrol. This is a drug which is injected. It lasts for 30 days. The addict cannot get high on opioids during those 30 days. The addict cannot tamper with this drug, cannot sell it because it's already been injected at the doctor's office. This drug is not available, to my knowledge, in Albany. There's one doctor who will prescribe it. He does not accept Medicaid. It costs $1,000 a month, which is probably another reason it's not widely available. I've spoken with the sales rep for Vivitrol, and he gave as an example some of his frustrations. St. Peter's has been 2.5 years trying to develop a policy on how to dispense Vivitrol. I think this drug should be offered to all addicts who are leaving treatment or all addicts who are leaving jail as a way for them to get through those 30, 60, 90, 360 days after they are done with the rehab. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Esther?
Hi, my name is Esther D'Amico. We're Italian, we get offended, I don't know. Anyway, it doesn't matter. My name is Esther, and I'm an addict, and I'm in recovery. When I was asked to come here last night, I got a text from a friend of mine, and she's like, oh my goodness, you know, like, they're gonna have something in Hudson Valley, and it's about drugs, and it's about heroin. You know, my hair stood up, and I was like, wow, that's great, you know? Like, I work right down the block in Taco Bell, and I'm thinking, okay, so I'm going to come in here, I'm going to speak to students about, like, I'm going to, like, see everybody I know that I serve in Taco Bell, and I'm going to let them know that, you know what? Heroin's not good, man. And, like, what I know is, I want to look at this at another point, another stand view. Like, I could be up here and let you know my story, you know, that I'm in recovery and I suffered on heroin. I could let you know that, and that's a story, you know. But there has to be some kind of solution. Like, I'm not here to beg for no, for funds. You know, I'm here to reach out to addicts. I'm here to say thank you. I'm here to say that, listen, man, I started using at 17. You know, I'm 57 years old now. I'm clean for over 10 years. And to get clean, I got on the methadone program. And I wanted to get off the methadone program, and they gave me hell. They didn't want me to get off. So I stayed on from the age of 17. No, I started using at 17. I got on when I was in my 20s, and I just got off 10 years ago. So I'm clean from methadone and all drugs in order to recover. So the first thing I had to do is stop using. And when I got off of methadone, I went into I try to get into hospitals, I try to get into St. Peter's, I try to get into places, and they didn't know what to do with me because I was clean for like 14 days and I thought I was going to die. And it took someone to reach out to me, who is a counselor and who's in recovery, And it's wonderful that you're going for your KSAC, and I wish I did, but I reach out to people in other ways. You know, I feel like I don't need no education to do that. What I need is a heart, and that's what I do. But I do need education, because otherwise I'm going to be stuck in Taco Bell forever. But, you know, it gets tiresome at my age. But so I want to commend you for that, and everyone else also here. I don't know where I was at just then. But what I want to say is that we don't have to suffer. It's about broken relationships. My heart goes out. I mean, to the mothers who have lost their children, I love you. I saw you in the paper, I believe. I love you. I want to give you a hug. You know. And what I want to say is, how many times has this man must have hit his knees and prayed to God for these people who are suffering? You know, so it has to take more than just money. It has to take, you know, like, we want to reach the higher ups. We want to reach the higher ups, and we want to ask for funding for this and for that. But the truth is that there's a higher up that I know, that I pray for everyone, like, whether you like wear a tie or a Taco Bell uniform, it doesn't matter. But it's about having people have hope, like allowing people like to reach out and say, you know what, there's hope, you know, and you're not alone. And that if I can do this, somebody who's been in shooting galleries, walking on stairs, having guns in their back, you know, coming from Brooklyn, like I don't know about this heroin highway, you know, and this stuff has existed for years. You know, like we were dying for years. Like, we died, man. You know, and thank God I had people who were not going to give me that other new drug that's out, but like give me a salt shot in my heart and stuff to get me back to life. You know, so I just want to say that I'm glad to be here. Like, I thought I was going to be talking to the students and to let them know that I love them and that when they come to Taco Bell, I'll give them a hug, and if they want, I'll reach out to them. But I'm here with you guys, and I guess there's a reason for the season. So I just want to say thank you, and I'm available if anybody needs help, if anybody wants to talk. Just saying.
Thank you, Esther. That was beautiful. And last but not least, Jennifer Haggerty.
Good evening. I don't know if I could follow that, but I might need a shield because I do want to ask for funding a little bit. I work for the Rensselaer County Department of Mental Health, and I am the supervisor for substance abuse services at the county level. And one of my favorite sayings is prevention works, treatment is effective, and we know that recovery is possible. At the county level, we feel all the barriers that have already been discussed tonight, so I'm not going to go over those. But I do want to ask to look at the prevention hat a little bit. I currently supervise 8 prevention staff out in the schools and communities. When I started 20 years ago, there were 20 of us. And now I currently have 8. I think we need to give young people from the age of 5 all the way through to young adulthood the skills that they need to address stress, pressures, early trauma in their life. So what skills are we giving them with the hopes to maybe prevent substance abuse, delay it, or even reduce it? We know there's many barriers to prevention, treatment, and recovery, but tonight I really want to wear the prevention hat, and I want to take a look at what we can do to start very, very young to give families and children the skills that they need to be healthy young adults. I am quick. Thank you.
Well, we have one more person.
I wrote that I wanted to speak, but I don't care, but that's okay. There's so many more important things to talk about. I just want to say that I am going to prepare my remarks. I'm a 25-year fire captain. My marriage was destroyed with addiction. I've had a lot of pain throughout family and friends to addiction. I'll address those. I'll write that down and send it to you. I just wanted to say that I was going to say these remarks, and I will send them in honor, and that's why I'm rising tonight, and I attended, of my brother-in-law, David Cunningham, who died 7 years ago today from heroin. I love them very much. I'm here for him today. And I'll send you those in his honor. But I also want to say earlier, my phone blew up. And I think this puts it in perspective. And I don't know if anybody saw me or knows me, but I got up and went out in the hall. A close family friend with a daughter, four daughters, one of his daughters, who has three children under 10. They found her dead from heroin today. And I was told that out in the hallway. So just if that puts it into perspective of everything we talked about tonight, I was just informed. So I'm going to go deal with that now. And just thank you for all you do. Thank you for all you went through. And thank you, all the professionals, what you do. Thank you very much. And God bless you all.
Is there anyone else that we missed that needed to share? Okay, one more person. Yes. Thank you for that. All right, so we've had an amazing discussion here, and I just want to again say thank you so much from all of us, from Friends of New York, and from the panel up here, and we're going to open it up now to the panelists. Steve?
No, I would just... I think I'll wrap up at the end, but I just want to offer up anybody that wants to say a few words or ask a few questions. Now is the time for our panelists, and just to thank you all for being here as well and for sharing your stories.
You guys want to go? You want me to go?
I learned a lot tonight by being here again. Thank you for inviting me. My portion of the equation is enforcement. It's my job to make the county safer for everybody. I'll continue to do that. I request any time you have any questions. We have a very active drug unit, and I know the retired detective down there talked about working with other agencies. We work with the Massachusetts State Police, the Southern Vermont Task Force, most of the local agencies here, the Drug Enforcement Administration, and we do have a mechanism in place when we do cross jurisdictions. We get deputized to where we can enforce the law in other jurisdictions. So that you're seeing that more and more, and I thank you for bringing that up because it's very important. You can't do it alone. Troy's problem is not just Troy's problem. Schenectady's problem is not just Schenectady's problem. It's the whole area. And I believe enforcement is necessary on mid-level drug dealers, and mid-level drug dealers belong in jail. The bad guys belong in jail, and it's my job to put them there, and I'll try to do the best I can for you for that.
Thank you.
I told you that we were doing reoccurring things. There were things that kept popping up. Two of the things I've heard in other forums that I haven't heard yet. Yeah, and now for the parents out there whose kids, are the, what's happening now is downstate there's a new phenomenon. If a person wants heroin, okay, they're actually calling a phone number and they get a distributor who's actually sending somebody out to the person's house. So now they're delivering it to the people's homes. Are you seeing that up here, too?
Yeah.
So that was one thing.
There's actually a really great book about that exact thing called Dreamland, and it gives you the history of all of that going back to the distributors from Mexico, and it's fascinating to read that. It really strikes very true. I recommend picking it up. It started in much smaller towns and now heading into bigger cities. But Dreamland, it's a very interesting read.
Okay. And the other thing, when we were talking about it, three phases, okay, like I was saying, the first phase that we're looking at is detox. And that's one of the most important phases because during that time, and I'm understanding, I keep hearing 3 days to detox. And then I'm hearing downstate 5 days a week. So it's not 3 days for a person to detox. And the other thing is that I'm looking at is people are telling me that people are on other medications, say it's pain medication or something like that. And in order to get to the problem, we have to wean them off all the medication, okay? And then really, if you really want to start the program of recovery, we need to do medical evaluation and a psychological evaluation to see what the underlying causes of the addiction are. Is that what you're finding also?
Yes.
All right. Okay. So, and the way we're looking at the detox centers, if we have the state set up detox centers and the state's paying for it, what we're looking at is not only are we going to detox, not only are we going to wean, and are we going to look at their medical, you know, conditions or the psychological problems that they may have, but during that time they have to form their own independent care plan for that patient, and at the same time they've got to look at what's available in order to pay for rehab or whatever else, whether it's the state's thing, whether it's Medicaid, whether there's funding from the insurance company, and they have to transition that person from the detox center to the rehab, okay? One of the things we're looking at, too, is we're looking to take away things from OASIS. So right now, if you look at rehab centers, okay, you may have the greatest rehab centers in the world. Some of the rehab centers around New York are not that good, okay? But what happens is you have hospitals and nursing homes, and hospitals and nursing homes have to be accredited, okay? And JCO comes in there and shines a microscope where nobody wants a microscope, okay? Matter of fact, this is their regulations just for rehab centers, okay? So right now, accreditation in New York State is voluntary for rehab centers. To me, that makes no sense because they're actually medical facilities. So one of the things we're looking at is requiring them to have accreditation. That takes responsibility away from OASIS. When we take responsibility away, we're looking to give them responsibilities. So one of the things we're looking at is the state will be responsible, OASIS, to maintain a database. And each rehab will have to call into the state and tell them how many beds, how many patients, how many open beds they have. And it'll be the state's responsibility to help to facilitate placement for people. So just wanted to give you an idea. And then once the rehab goes, the care plan goes with the patient. Once they're in rehab, they have to have an individual aftercare program. And this is some of the things we're talking about. In the aftercare, you're going to go to sober houses or you're going to go to a halfway house. But they have to be regulated also, because we have a sober house by me for people with alcohol problems. And if you go by there on a Sunday night, they're sitting around a fire pit having a beer. How's that one working out? Okay. So they're going to have responsibilities also. And they get a lot of money from our counties. They get a lot of money from different people. And we're looking at response. They have to have a drug counselor that's OASIS certified to watch with the aftercare program and to assist these people now after they've gone through rehab, whether they need their GED, whether they need their the college courses or a job training program to bring them back into society. So I think there's three parts to it, you know. And as far as the insurance is concerned, a lot of this stuff gets paid for by the state level. A lot of it, you know, we have the health care. But a lot of it, look, they put in a bill that there's supposed to be 30 days of rehab. And, you know, my way of thinking is insurance companies, sometimes you cut off your nose to spite your face, and sometimes you step over a dollar to pick up a dime. So instead of turning around and paying for 7 days, 8 days, 9 days, another time, 10 days, another time, and keep paying through the roof, sometimes it's more cost-effective, even for insurance companies, to get it done right the first time, okay? So, and it costs us a lot more to incarcerate people than it does to treat them. So I just want to let you know there's a lot of things that we're looking at. And it's funny that you mentioned the advocate, because that was one of my first four pages of notes. But anyway, we're going to be around. I'm going to be around after this. If you want to come up and talk to me, if you didn't feel comfortable coming up and speaking on the mic, you know I sound like an old Brooklyn cop, but I'm approachable. Come up, talk to me, and I'd like to get your input, and I might pick your brain on a couple different issues. But I want to thank everybody for coming out here tonight. You know, you have no idea how helpful you've been, and we're going to put this together. You're going to be able to see it when we're done. But I'll tell you, the time that you've given us is invaluable. And I just want to say from the bottom of my heart, thank you.
Thank you, Senator. I just wanted to ask whether there were our panelists, any other panelists who had some thoughts as we wrap up.
I want to say a few things. Again, my name is Brian. I want to thank you guys all for coming out here tonight. And my heart goes out to all of you that have lost someone to this disease. You know, it really hits home to me because I went through it. And, you know, I just want to say that, you know, I was listening to you guys speak, and, you know, something that I heard a lot was talking about prevention. And, you know, that's something I've been very passionate about and what I've been doing. And I know that there's not enough of it out there. Because I've done a lot of it over the past few years, just all volunteer for free. And, like, you know, at one point in time, like, I was doing, like, three different schools, and I'm not getting paid for that stuff. You know, I'm doing all of the goodness of my heart, you know. And, you know, sometimes some points of this whole thing, I feel like I should be down there asking these guys questions. Like, you know, that's just how I feel. But, you know, there are people out there like myself that are doing this. And, you know, I'm also a member of YPR, which is Young People in Recovery. And we're a non-for-profit organization. We're out there, you know, going to high schools. We're going to all the community events in the community. And, you know, meeting other people like myself and working with other organizations, other non-for-profits, and, like, really getting in there and helping people. And, you know, for me, YPR has helped me a lot because it's been an outlet. I'm working with other people in recovery. I am going to Washington this weekend. I can't wait. I'm really excited. I lost my train of thought. But, you know, now, oh yeah, so YPR, and, you know, there are people, Oasis does fund, they do have recovery coaches, but there's not enough, that's for sure. You know, doing the whole prevention work, I know that programs like YPR, and there's, I mean, that's the only one I'm familiar with right now. Like, I mean, people are doing this all on their own, you know? And there's so much more we could do if we had the funding to do so, you know? And it's, I'm not like to beg. Like, I love doing it. Like, I go out there and do it myself. I've been doing it for years for free. But it would be nice to get a paycheck. And I'm just really glad to be here and glad to hear all you guys' input, because it really makes me want to continue to do what I'm doing, and I'm really happy that I'm in school now getting an education, and I will be able to get a paid position in what I want to do someday. So again, thank you all for coming here. And
well, I'm Sandy McCarthy, the late one, but as an advocate for people who are accused of committing crimes, I just, from my perspective, I think it's more helpful. I think what we do now is we separate people. We have a lot of separation. It's us and it's them. They're the bad guys, we're the good guys. But really, it's not like that. Everybody's got a story. And the more I think the most effective tools are where the community is coming together to care about each other, even the criminals, you know what I mean? Like everybody, because they all have a story too, you know, like some of the speakers have pointed out. And, you know, some of the restorative justice programs, making drug court, making us be able to maybe to get by the DA sometimes to get more people into drug court so that we can scoot around, no offense. You know what I mean? And so that there are the resources that really have this sort of global effect on people and really can help them, even the criminals, to address all of your different issues, whether it's mental health or cognitive. We miss cognitive a lot. There's a lot of cognitive impairment. People that just, life is too stressful for some people, you know what I mean? And, you know, we could do, if we cared more instead of demonizing them and trying to throw them away, because you can only throw them away so long. You throw them away for 2 or 3 years, they're getting out. You just nothing. And you've taken a criminal and turned them into an animal. So, anyway.
An expungement statute.
An expungement statute. We need, and thank you, thank you. We need a way to expunge a criminal history. At some point, we need to forgive Matt. We need to forgive him and let him get on with his life and let him get a decent job. We need to forgive whoever here has a criminal conviction. Like a real way to expunge, not just a sealing, but a forgiveness, you know? And really forgive people and let them move on with their lives. And, you know, the statute of limitations for, you know, felonies is like 6 years. But if you get caught, so anything that anybody up here did 6 years or more ago, that's forgiven. But somebody who got caught, which is usually poor people, and usually people in indigent communities, they carry that around for the rest of their life, and they can never fully integrate into society again. And they're kept as second-class citizens forever. So that's it.
I'll stay in line here and say a few words about the disease, I think, as we hear about this. In 1956, the American Medical Association declared alcoholism as a disease, and that was really the standard for addiction being a disease. It's not a disease concept. It's not something that is up for debate. This is a disease. To all of the people who spoke tonight, especially those of you who have lost children and lost loved ones to this disease, my heart goes out to you. And at the same time, your courage is just so inspiring to me. The people that are here, and those of you that are still getting up and putting your shoes on and going out the door, and not only that, but you are not allowing what is happening to continue. The way this disease is being treated is not working. There are some things that are wrong here. Your stories are the things that will change that. Your stories have power. As somebody, I'll speak to being an instructor here at Hudson Valley. I love this program. I went through this program to get my KSAC years ago. One of the things that I talk about first and foremost with my students is the denial that the people with this disease go through.
when you talk about why are they still going back to this, if you think of it as an abusive relationship, those of you that are in grief because you've lost people know about the grief process. Denial is the first part. If we can get the sick person to a trained counselor, I've heard a few of them here tonight, you can hear that their heart is in the right place, we can teach them how to break through that denial. And we've got a scholarship waiting for you. I'd like to get you into the program, too. But unless we get two things, unless we get the money, first of all, and I like the idea, where is the money coming from? And not just the money, but the managed care companies to say, you're going to do what the CASAC, the trained addiction professional, says, not anybody else says, the changes aren't going to happen. So the things I would encourage you to advocate for, yes, let's get some more money. It's sorely missing. But also when you have a trained professional, we work with 40-some addiction places. Conifer Park is one of them. These people did not get into this for any other reason than they want to help fight this disease, but their hands are tied when they're not listening to the recommendations that are being made. So I would encourage you to advocate for that, and thank you. Your voices are being heard. Keep them loud and keep them up. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian.
I guess it seems appropriate that I talk next. It's been, for me, energizing to listen to everyone speak. I'm really proud to have there's two people here tonight who spoke that I work with. They don't work for me. I don't work for them. We work together. And it makes me feel so good to hear their passion and to hear what they really feel good about doing. Because it's a pretty thankless job. A lot of times I go home and kind of feel beaten up by it. But the fact is I get to go home, and you all are fighting the good fight all the time, and it amazes me. So on behalf of treatment and the things that we do to try to help, I want to apologize because I know we come up short, and I know that we don't do enough to get through to everybody. But the things that you've given to me tonight and to my coworkers who are here tonight and that have spoken, the energy that I'm going to take away from this and try to help with treatment, I'm grateful for your word. So thank you.
Let me finish. I don't think you fail, by the way. I think you do a great job. As we said when we started, as a conference, we have been doing this for a while now, the planning stages and then to the actual hearings. The ideas and the heart-wrenching stories you've told us today will be incorporated into what we do as we move forward with these ideas that you give us to try to make it better. That's what we can do as a government. We can try to make it better. We can try to identify funding sources. We may find new ways to fund things. But it's through the efforts of people like this and those of you out there that have battled royally, that have told us that we need to have more parental intervention and need to have them part of the process of recovery. We know that. We know we need alternatives. We know we need drug court. We know that these are things that are necessary. And some of the bills that have passed that haven't been signed yet, that fight's not over. That fight's not over. We will continue to do that. We're out here now after a few years of people being out here listening, and we have concentrated on these components that we've talked about today because we believe this is the way, to quote everybody here, to recovery for all of us as a society, not just some of us. So that's what we have to do to make all of us whole and to get to the next step to make our country, our state, and our little communities a better place to live. God bless you all.
Thank you, Assemblyman. And before Assemblyman McLaughlin gives his closing remarks, I do want to thank the Assembly Minority Task Force on Heroin Addiction and Community Response for partnering. I want to thank Nick very much for your courage and your work on this and the rest. I also want to make a really quick announcement. On 10/4/15, that's this weekend, this Sunday, there will be a bus leaving from Albany to go to D.C., to the Washington, D.C. march. It's a recovery march. They're projecting 100,000 people from all over the country are going to come and rally on behalf of addiction prevention, treatment, and recovery. So please come see us. We're going to be outside, myself, Bob. Come talk to us. We'd love to sign you up. We've got a sign-up sheet here. And I also want to say that as a person myself in long-term recovery, I have a tattoo on my wrist, and it says, live your life, not your story. And because of the gift that I've been given, along with so many of us here, I just want to, again, thank the folks in the treatment community, our legislators, our law enforcement, who's working on behalf of this issue. It takes a village, and so I really do thank all of you for being here again.
Well, just to wrap things up, I just would like to first thank Hudson Valley Community College and Drew Matnack, the president, for hosting this. They're always available for anything we need. So I want to thank Hudson Valley for giving us the room this evening. I want to thank Stephanie for moderating. Great job, Steph. Thank you. I appreciate that very much. Jim Todisco stayed as long as he could. He just wanted me to express that he had to duck out because it was his sister-in-law's, I think, 70th birthday, and they were having dinner, and he was late and already in trouble. But Jim obviously cares deeply about these issues as well, you know, as we all do. I want to thank the panel for being here tonight and our assembly staff who was throughout the room for setting everything up, getting the word out about this event. So thank you. Our staff sometimes doesn't get the accolades that they deserve, but they make us look good all the time. I want to thank my chief of staff, Jennifer, for being here and helping out with this as well. And mostly I want to thank all of you for being here, because I said at the beginning, this helps us as legislators and as law enforcement and as DA. It helps all of us learn how to be better at what we need to do so that we can turn around and help you more in what you need. So this was a great event. I took a lot of notes. I emailed myself some notes just in case I lose these notes. So I was able to capture a lot. And, you know, I can tell you as a father, a lot of this just scares the hell out of me. You know, thankfully, my family has not been touched by this, but clearly anybody's family can be touched by this. So it scares me. We heard tonight, you hear some pain, you hear some despair, but you hear an awful lot of hope as well. And I think that by sharing your stories, you see some similarities, but everybody's story is different in their own personal way and in their own family's journey through this. And the one thing I've seen is that clearly all of us are in this together, and the only way to overcome this, whether we have been directly touched by it or not, is by working together to raise the awareness. And we, you know, we heard about the prevention, the law enforcement, the treatment, the recovery, and really, I think another common theme is the insurance companies really not stepping up to the plate in a way that they should and could. And that's something that we will certainly be taking back to Albany with us. And I can tell you that everybody on the panel here that is in office really in the, on this panel would not be reluctant to stand up to those insurance companies. And I think we continue to do that on a daily basis. So in closing, thanks for being here. We went a little bit long, but that's okay, because these stories need to be told. And people need to be heard, and it certainly helped us immensely, and I hope you found some comfort and strength in being here, and I wish you all well. And we will be here for a little bit longer. If you have some people don't want to come up to the mic, but they still want to be heard, we'll certainly listen and do whatever we can to help. Thank you very much for being here. God bless.
Now I know, Bill. Yeah.